Bowling Green Falcons welcome an old rival to Perry Stadium, the Miami Redhawks, who have a conference crown in sight.
It's our game! It's our game! Win all three! 1, 2, 3, win!
Welcome to ESPN College Football Primetime from Bowling Green, Ohio, from Perry Stadium. Tonight, a back matchup between the Miami Redhawks and the Bowling Green Falcons. A look at the MAC East Division standings as Bowling Green going for their second conference win tonight, and Miami would love to create a logjam atop the Eastwood Temple and Ohio. We welcome you in along with former Washington Husky and NFL defensive back J.C. Pearson. I am Mark Neely. J.C., the Miami head coach, Michael Haywood, in his second season last year, they were 1-11, but this year have an eye on a conference crown. What has caused the turnaround in Oxford?
Well, he's really changed the culture of his football team, both on and off the football field. May they make sure that the kids are in class, on time, sitting in the front row. The uptown area in town is off limits after 10 o'clock at night, but I think the biggest change has been in the way they practice. They practice early in the morning before school, 6, 7 a.m. in the morning. That forces kids to get in the bed at night, get their rest, and I think they're more focused and more accountable. Seems to be working for them.
But unorthodox, but indeed working for them. They have a sophomore quarterback, Zach Dysart, an emotional leader.
Yeah, sometimes a little too emotional. It causes him to get in trouble throwing interceptions. They really want him to take the emotion out of his game. Stay cool, calm, and collected. The last 3 weeks, it seems to be working. He's thrown for an average of over 320 yards, and he's got a couple talented receivers to throw the ball to. Armand Robinson is in the top five all-time at Miami in career catches and receiving yards, and teams have really tried to take him away by doubling him, and it's opened up the other side of the field for Nick Harwell, one of the hottest receivers in the country right now. Over the last 4 weeks, 33 catches, almost 500 yards.
Bowling Green trying to make it back-to-back wins and back-to-back weeks this week. Now, last week at Central Michigan, probably their best defensive effort of the season.
Yeah, and when you go back to the last 3 weeks, they've gotten better and better and better, and you can point really to one guy. Chris Jones up front had a huge game last week. 5 tackles for losses, 3.5 sacks, and a fumble recovery. He's got to have another game like that tonight, but I suspect that Miami's going to double-team him all night tonight.
Well, some of the fans here at Perry Stadium are trying to make some history of their own tonight by being part of the largest human ESPN sign. It's a MAC battle. Miami at Bowling Green, and the opening kickoff is straight ahead.
ESPN's College Football Prime Time, brought to you by Call of Duty Black Ops Rated M.
Bowling Green Falcons taking the field, their home field, at Perry Stadium. Take on one of their rivals, the Miami Redhawks, tonight. These rivals played 4 years ago right here. They had a lot of rain that particular day. This happened to be a natural grass field at the time, which turned into a natural mud field. It was a low-scoring game. It was aired here on ESPN in 2006. Trailing 9-7, Bowling Green, Sean Ellis misses wide left on a 25-yard field goal attempt. Obviously, the conditions had something to do with that. And it finished 9-7. Miami, now the very next year, they changed the field turf, which they still have here. And the rain is not going to be factor tonight, because they have the field turf anyway. There's a look at the head coach, the Bowling Green Falcons. Daquan it in his second season. They were 7-6 a year ago and 6-2. They have definitely faced some adversity this season,
yeah,
especially on the offensive line.
A lot of injuries up front. They've had to move guys from the defensive side to the offensive side to play on the offensive line. They've moved guys from guard to center, from tackle to guard. So they've really had to try to just fit guys in there, and it's really hurt them offensively, and they've had to simplify their offense.
Michael Haywood, also in his second season as a head coach, as the offensive coordinator for Charlie Weiss at Notre Dame. Of course, he played at Notre Dame. Also was an assistant at Texas, LSU, Ball State, Ohio. This guy's been around, finally getting his chance and is making his mark.
Yeah, he really is, but he's learned from some of the best in the business, obviously, like you said, and now's his turn, and he still relies on a lot of those guys for guidance and for help.
Miami won the toss. They will receive. DeMarco Payne, junior out of St. Louis, back to receive the opening kick. Miami in their white uniforms with the red trim, and Bowling Green will have the orange tops with the white pants tonight. And we are set to go from Bowling Green, Ohio. Great to have you along with us on this Wednesday night in this matchup. From the 5-yard line, Green, let's get across the 20 before being tackled by Jovan Laycock. And the starting quarterback, he's a sophomore from Ada, Ohio, Zach Dysert.
You can see those 12 interceptions right there. That's what we talked about in the open, and that's where the emotion got the best of him, throwing those interceptions. Really tried to do a little too much and force some balls, and they really worked on him to try to tone that down.
Dysinger took over as the starter in week 3 last year for the Red Hawks. Robinson goes in motion. Swing it out to the right side, and Harwell gets the quick catch up to the 31-yard line. Let's take a look at that Red Hawks offense. We just mentioned Harwell in his last 4 games. And JC mentioned this in the open. Last 4 games, 33 catches for 475 yards. And on the offensive line, Matt Kennedy starts at left tackle. He has been out with an ankle sprain and a shoulder injury. So pickup of 6, second down and 4. Ball at the 30-yard line of the Red Hawks. Under center this time, Dysert. Murray Weathers straight ahead. Going to be a little shy of the first down for a gain of 3. The Bowling Green defense, they run a 4-2-5. Their D-line, Chris Jones, the 6 sacks. Big week last week against Central Michigan. The 2 linebackers, Dwayne Woods, one of the leaders in the nation with 98 tackles. And defensive back Keith Morgan leads the Falcons with 3 interceptions. It gets a first down, enough on that last carry. So it moved the chains, 1st and 10, and another carry straight ahead. Merriweather up near the 38, 39-yard line. Both these teams want to run the football more.
They do, and they both are very similar in that they've had a ton of injuries up front. Miami's offensive line, they've been beat up. Like you said, Matt Kennedy coming back for the first time in 5 weeks, starting at left tackle. That moves Brandon Brooks inside to guard. So this is only the 2nd time all year that they've had in consecutive weeks the same 5 up front. So they're trying to piece it together as well and try to get a running game going.
Gibbons and Harwell wide right. Gibbons comes in motion into the slot and a handoff, but a pre-snap whistle and maybe a false start here.
False start. Offense. Number 11. 5-yard penalty. The down remains 2nd.
You got Robinson removing early. Well, that'll cost him 5, move it to 2nd and 10.
And, you know, you mentioned that both teams want to try to run the ball, and Miami thinks that they can get it done tonight, even though Merriweather's still dealing with the sore shoulder. But they think that Bowling Green defensively, they're giving up an average of 208 yards rushing a game. Miami thinks that they can take advantage of that and get their running game going.
Draw Merriweather. Spins his way across the 40. near the 44-yard line. He's only going to be a yard or two shy the first down before Jerry Boo Boo Gates, the Rover, came up to make the tackle.
See, this offensive line just comes off just past that, and then they run the draw, and Merriweather's a good back. He's got over 1,000 career yards. Now he just needs a little crease, and he's able to get some positive yards in there. That's what they want to try to do, because if they can run the ball and be more balanced, it takes a lot of pressure off of Dicer, the young quarterback.
A third and one. Give it right back to Merriweather, and looks like he will have the first down across the 45. Champ Fells, Buck linebacker, brings him down, but it will be a first down for Miami. Just enough on that last carry for Merriweather. First down from the Red Hawks 45-yard line. First possession of the football game just underway from Bowling Green, Ohio. Dicer, quick drop, throws to the right side, caught Robinson. Quickly brought down right near midfield by Adrian Spencer, the cornerback, leans forward to the 49-yard line of Bowling Green.
Bowling Green defensively, they're going to try to change some things up. Normally, they're just a zone team. They play a lot of soft coverages, give you a lot of room in the back end. Don't blitz a lot, but tonight they want to try to blitz more. First and second down, try to throw the timing of the quarterback, Dicer, off, but also they're going to switch up their personnel. You see a penalty here, but you see four defensive linemen. They're going to go with three, sometimes even two, to try to change things up.
Just a quick official timeout there. So second down and four from the 49 of the Falcons. Gibbons in motion. Handoff. Merriweather stutter step. He got handled by the shirt tail there. It does gain a yard or so. Champ Fells able to grab him. Was initially grabbed by the shirt tail behind the line of scrimmage, but did get a positive yardage out of it.
Calvin Marshall, number 10, is going to come on the blitz. Like we talked about, they're going to bring more pressure. Does a good job avoiding him, but then the rest of that Bowling Green defense is able to close in on him.
So third down again, third down and three. Red Hawks 1-1 so far on third down on this drive. And from the gun, Dicer, that's deflected and knocked down. But wait, a timeout had been called by Bowling Green before the snap. No play.
Play. Timeout. Defense. They're first.
Stan Evans, our referee.
Media timeout.
Maybe one that Bowling Green wants back. It's going to be another chance on third down when we come back for Miami. First possession of the football game still for the Miami Redhawks. They face a third down and three from the 48-yard line of Bowling Green. Dysart rolling right. Little shovel. Robinson has the first down across the 40. Down to the 38-yard line. Boo Boo Gates with the tackle. Nice little shovel pass. And Robinson is 61st catch of the season to lead the Redhawks.
And really, it's just another way to run the option. You see, they're going to option off of the linebacker. Actually, it's number 91 right there that they've optioned off of. If he jumps up, then they pitch it inside. If he stays inside, then Dysart will just keep the ball around the outside. And that was Chris Jones, the defensive tackle.
Ball spotted at the 40-yard line of the Falcons. First down for Miami. Dysart hands it off. Merriweather running left. Cuts it back upfield. He picks up nine. Calvin Marshall, the rover, with the tackle. But that's a big gain on first down, and it's been a good night so far for Merriweather here early.
It has, and Bowling Green came in. They're normally an eight-man front defense, but tonight they wanted to give a six-, seven-man front look and play more pass coverage because that's Miami's strength. Then they were hoping that they weren't going to have to go back to the eight-man box to stop the run, and it looks like they're going to have to. You can see all the guys in the box right now.
Merriweather averaging 36 yards rushing per game. Hardy has 30 now. Tack on a little more there. Does have the first down inside the 30. Champ Fells, another tackle for the Falcons.
We talked about the emphasis coming in, wanting to run the football. We can see how much of an emphasis they're making on it. I mean, coming in, they're only averaging 63 yards a game rushing, but you wouldn't tell by the way they're running the ball right now.
For the 11th play of the drive coming up, for Miami, who won the toss, received, that are marching down the field now to the 30-yard line of Bowling Green. Givens in motion, comes into the slot on the left side. Warren Merriweather this time running right, gets around the corner, inside the 20. We'll mark him out of the sideline near the 15-yard line. Henri Davis and Champ Fells ushering him out, but a pickup of 15. And Merriweather's finding a lot of open green out there right now.
And again, right now, Bowling Green doesn't have enough guys in the box. You can count them. There's six guys right there in the box to try to stop the run. Just not enough guys. You can see right now, Merriweather gets right to the edge. There's no outside contain, and now he's got an easy 15-yard gain.
Redhawks already almost at their season average in rushing yards per game here on their first drive, which has eaten up 6 minutes and counting. Merriweather. Get a lot more east-west than north-south running that time before Javon Laycock, the junior from Jamaica, Queens, New York, brought him down.
And he's one of those guys, the safeties that's normally down in the box to stop the run. He's the second leading tackler on the team, and you're going to see him show up right off the edge on the run. He's a little closer to the line of scrimmage, so now he can come up and make that tackle for a loss.
So loses a yard. Second and 11 from the 16. Robinson in motion, now back to the right side. Dysart, plenty of time, now steps up. He's going to run with it. And leads forward down near the five. Boo Boo Gates, the freshman from Middletown, Ohio, gets credit for the tackle.
And that was a concern for the Bowling Green defensive coaches, is when Dysart runs the ball, because he's a capable guy with his legs. Although he doesn't have a lot of rushing yards, he's able to make some things happen with his legs when things break down. But what they're really concerned about is when he gets outside the pocket and is able to throw the ball. That's a big concern for him.
Redhawks 2 of 2 on third down so far on this drive. It's third and three here from inside the 10. Pitch. Merriweather lost the football. It's loose, picked up by the Falcons. The turnover on Reed Davidson in the right place at the right time for Bowling Green, and a methodical drive for the Redhawks comes to an end with a costly turnover by Merriweather.
You just got to secure the ball. It's a little cold out here. You got to make sure you catch it. Just took his eyes off of it. You got to treat that pitch as though it's a pass. Look that ball all the way in. He got his eyes up too early, looking at the defender, seeing where he's able to go, and just dropped the ball.
So the Falcons with their 26th takeaway of the season, third most in Football Bowl subdivision.
Yeah, that was a takeaway, but that was more of a giveaway by Merriweather.
An unforced error.
Right.
Merriweather had such success on that drive until that moment. And Matt Shills, the redshirt freshman quarterback from Arcadia, California. So the Falcons take over on their own 12-yard line. Finally in motion. Pre-snap whistle. May have gotten the wide receiver Jordan with a false start.
And that's something that really drives coaches crazy. That should never happen, because as a wide receiver, you're lined up outside. You're looking in at the ball. So whether you can hear or anything, you shouldn't even be paying attention to the snap count. You just watch the ball, just like the defenders do when they hike it, you go. Never an excuse for a receiver to jump off sides.
No, I don't so need that.
7:29 on the clock.
You know, they got it. They just got it.
They're on 7 yard line. So Shields moves into the shotgun, standing at his own one. 4-2. Handoff. Willie Jeter picks up three. Take a look at the Bowling Green offensive starters. Wide receiver Calvin Wiley, he is a sixth-year senior who will line up a quarterback in the Wildcat on occasion. And the Bowling Green offensive line has had some continuity issues this season, to say the least. Scott Lewis starts at center for the second straight week as the three-year starter at center, Ben Boychuk, dealing with a shoulder injury.
That's really something to watch. You mentioned Scott Lewis, the second week starting at center. He's never played center before until last week. So this is where they've had the issues in shotgun.
Lewis has been the right guard, and saw Jordan Brown contact with Lewis.
False start offense. Number 68. Half the distance to the goal. The down remains second.
Usually don't see the center called for false starts.
And all of these downs are learning experiences for him, because he's never done it, like
exactly.
We just said.
And he's been the right guard usually.
The right guard. They had to move to center last week for the first time. Had a lot of issues, some snap issues in shotgun, but he played hard. And that's one thing they said about him. Didn't grade out very well, but tonight we got to make sure that we watch the quarterback center exchange.
So the penalty half the distance makes it just inside the five. Tied in Bear in motion. Hand off Jeter, off right tackle. Across the 10 to the 11-yard line, Jason Sims with the tackle. Let's look at that Miami defense. The just aforementioned in Jason Sims sat out last season after transferring from the University of Iowa. Linebacker Evan Harris leads the Red Hawks with three interceptions. And cornerback D.J. Brown, his dad David, you may remember him, played at Ohio State and also in the NFL with the Atlanta Falcons.
And their M.O. defensively is create chaos. They want to move around. They're going to bring a lot of pressure. They're going to attack, try to create some confusion and see if they can get a big hit on the quarterback.
A lot of action on that line. Here comes the rush on third and 10, tipped. And it falls at the 5, incomplete. Just what you were talking about there, J.C. There came Anthony Kokel, the free safety, creating that confusion there.
Yeah, a lot of pressure coming, but they were trying to run a screen here. You're going to see Kokel coming through. Kind of confuses them. But as an offensive lineman, you see, they just let him come through. Even when you're running a screen, you want to hit him and block him for a second before you release. That time, the offensive line never blocked anyone up front. They just took off.
Marco Payne standing back near midfield. Takes a Bowling Green bounce near the 40. And apparently he called for a fair catch. So as soon as Payne came up with the ball at the 41, the back judge whistled it dead. So Zach Dyson will come back out for the Redhawks for their second possession with 5:35 to go in this first quarter.
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Castrol GTX, with superior protection against harmful deposit buildup. And Acura, the most innovative thinking you'll find in an Acura.
That's the newly constructed SEBO Center, which is just beyond the north end zone here. The front door to Doit Perry Stadium, almost 43,000 square feet for Bowling Green football. It has luxury suites there as well, offices, training facilities, band seating, and more just beyond the north end zone here at Perry Stadium. It's the Doit.
Nice facility. We went through it yesterday. Very nice. Should definitely help Coach Clawson in recruiting.
Absolutely. Redhawks take over on their own 41. And Dyser going deep down the sideline. And that's caught in stride. Down to the 18-yard line goes Nick Harwell. Henri Davis bringing it down, but not before a gain of 40. Make it 41 yards.
Yeah, they run the out and up on Davis. Watch at the top of the screen. Watch the out cut. Davis just turns his head and looks at the quarterback, and that's a no-no because now Nick Harwell turns it up on the go, and he's wide open. Good pump fake. But Henri Davis has got to make sure that he has his man covered and in position before he looks at the quarterback.
Well, after their first drive was really methodical on the ground, they go right to the air. And their first play of the second drive, but now on the ground, Merriweather towards the pylon. Is he in? Apparently stepped out just inside the one. Javon Laycock able to get to him just before he got to the pylon of the end zone.
Good couple of cuts right here by Merriweather. Watch the one right there, and then watch this one. Oop! Hands out a minus right there on Henri Davis again. And gets around the corner and gets to the pylon. I mean, looked like he hit the pylon before he got out. But look at Henri Davis again. He's got to keep outside leverage, keep his head outside. That's two plays in a row that they've gone after Henri Davis.
Right now, officially a gain of 17. First and goal. They are going to review here to see if Merriweather got in.
You're going to see at the end of the run right here. Looks like he's going to get the ball over the pylon. Now, was his feet out of bounds prior to him getting there? That's going to be the question.
Oh, there. That's the best look right there. Like the ball in hand hits pylon.
Right, but where was his foot? They called him out of bounds. Was his foot out of bounds before he got to the pylon? You see that left toe right there? Looks like it's still in.
And again, the ruling on the field is no touchdown, so there has to be video proof to overrule.
It has to be conclusive video proof to show that he's still in bounds there. Indisputable evidence. And I don't know if they've got that there.
Because of what you just said, where is the left toe when the ball hits the pylon? Another look. Yeah, with the tackle being made of Laycock, it really screens with that where that left foot is.
Yeah, it's awfully close, and you don't get a clear look at where that foot is. Is it out of bounds? Is it inbounds? This is the only look we have. And that's tough, right? I mean, right there, it looks like that it's still in bounds, but is that indisputable? Is it clear enough to overrule the call?
Tom Workman is our replay official. And by the way, while they're looking at that, let's go back on that the punt real quick, because we were confused on the punt.
Unusual call. I mean, he called a Peter call, which tells his blocker to get away, never signaled fair catch, but yet they blew it down.
Here's the punt. Brian Wright's punt for Bowling Green. Okay.
Following the review, replay shows that the runner was not out of bounds until after the ball crossed the pylon. The result of play there was
wow. So they saw enough in the booth to say that he did get in. So touchdown for Merriweather. And the Redhawks take a 6-0 lead. We'll get back to that punt a little bit later, which was an unusual play in itself.
Number 19, Trevor Cook. Back to Devon Avenue.
Trevor Cook, who'd been out for a few weeks with injury, is back handling the place kicking. Injured a left leg at Central Michigan on October 16th. So Merriweather gets the touchdown run, his sixth rushing touchdown of the season. And the Redhawks take a 7-0 lead. Well, the touchdown run for Barry Weather, 7-0 Red Hawks with just under 5 minutes to go in the first quarter from here in Bowling Green, Ohio. Miami Red Hawks, a team that was 1-11 a year ago, trying to go to 5-1 in conference play with a win here tonight. Zach Dysart, the big throw, 41-yard reception by Harwell. That's now four consecutive games that Dysart has had a 40-plus yard completion, seventh time this year that he's had a 40-plus yard completion.
And when they can get the running game going, something that they very rarely have done all year, but when they can get the running game going, takes a lot of pressure off of him, makes it easier to throw the ball.
Seth Phillips kickoff. Boo Gates, who has returned to kickoff for touchdown this year, that was against Kent State. Across the 30-yard line, Harris Edwards with the tackle. All right, let's go back to the punt. And when it happened, I thought maybe fair catch, but as soon as the ball hits the ground on the punt,
they blew it dead.
Then the fair catch is off.
But there's no fair catch. Watch the return man back there. He signals Peter, telling his blocker to get out of the way, and then the ball hits. He catches it, and they blow it dead.
As soon as he touched it, and the ruling we received was the replay blue told us that once he gives that safe sign, that as soon as he picks it up, the play is dead. I had not seen that before.
Yeah, that's a new one on me.
There's a completion to the tight end, Alex Baer, to the 40-yard line. So a gain of 9 on first down. Harris and Gafford with the tackles for the Red Hawks. We'll see how the Falcons respond here. Now down a touchdown with under 4.5 minutes to go in this first quarter.
And offensively, they really simplified things the last couple of weeks because of all the confusion up front by their offensive line and shuffling guys. So they really don't even have their full offensive package to run tonight.
Jeter goes in motion, the empty backfield. Chills, they're trying to set up that screen, and that is well read and a loss. Evan Harris, the weak side linebacker, would have nothing to do with that, and the sophomore from Waldorf, Maryland, in on the tackle.
Well, Harris does a good job reading the screen, and they know that the screen game is huge for Bowling Green. They run a lot of screens to receivers, to running backs, to tight ends, to everybody. That's one thing that Miami was looking forward to coming into this game, was stopping the screens.
Well, from second and one now to 3rd and 5 after a loss of 4.
See all the movement up front by Miami defensively. He's trying to create some confusion.
Shields across the middle and incomplete. Nobody home there. Perhaps Pronti, the intended receiver.
And it looked like Pronti was open there. You know, what Shields have to do is not worry about the guys up front. Trust his offensive linemen to pick up those guys up front that are moving around and keep his eyes down the field. Can't get too antsy back there in the back end.
Paid back to receive the punt at the 25. See if he learns not to give the safe sign anymore. The ball hits the ground. It won't this time. Good punt from White. And that time, he does give the fair catch at the 13-yard line. Let's take a look back with our Acura Drive recap for the Miami Red Hawks. And right away on this drive, 41-yard completion to Nick Harwell.
Yeah, right away to Harwell, and then the run to Merriweather. Great job with his feet, getting back to the outside, getting all the way in for the touchdown. We'll see if they come back and go back at number 26, the redshirt freshman corner, Andre Davis over there. Gave up 2 big plays in that touchdown drive.
Dysart swings it out low, but caught by Robinson to the 19-yard line. Angelo Magnoni brings it down. Let's go into the studio and get an update. Here's Ryan Burr. Ryan. Thank you. Hey, Ryan, thanks very much. A little too early in this game before I ask you your opinion on Cam Newton, JC. I'm going to let you sit on that one.
Yeah, please
do. For a little while.
Yeah, might need some time to talk about that one.
Tracy Woods, the backup to Merriweather, gets the carry. Woods, a freshman from Galena Park, Texas. Well, Miami getting it done on the ground here tonight. They have already exceeded their per-game season average for rushing.
Yeah, and you look at them and you wonder how can they have only averaged 62.8 yards rushing per game coming in the way that they're running the ball tonight. You know, maybe it's Matt Kennedy being back at left tackle and solidified that offensive front.
Two tight ends, hand off Woods. And on third and short, gets the first down for Dwayne Woods. As the tackle. Big time college football action continues all week on ESPN and ESPN2. First on ESPN Thursday night at 7:30 Eastern. Big East leader Pittsburgh takes on Connecticut. Then on ESPN2 Friday night at 9 Eastern, Kellen Moore and number 4 Boise State travel to Idaho. Go to ESPN.com for more information. Actually, I guess they're staying in Idaho. They travel to Moscow, Idaho.
Can't be too long of a trip, huh?
I don't know, it's kind of a big state. Dicer sacked. Back at the 15-yard line, Kevin Alvarado and Darius Smith.
And that's what they've got to do. Watch number 3. Right in the middle of your screen, Alvarado just beats the center, gets up the field, and gets the sack on Dicer. If they can just go ahead and get pressure with just 4 guys, and you can see 2 of them, of those 4 get to the quarterback, then they can drop the other 7 in coverage like they would like to do, but they've got to be able to stop the run first without having to commit 8 guys.
9-yard loss, 2nd and 19. Nicer draw play, Moore to the 30. Gets past the original line of scrimmage. Tracy Woods, that is. Jovan Leacock helping out on the tackle. We're inside the last 30 seconds of this first quarter.
Yeah, and the problem is they're normally an 8-man front, but tonight they want to only be a 6- or 7-man front. And you can see the guys, there's only 7 guys in the box right there, and that's not enough for them to stop the run. Normally they have another guy down in the box, and you can see Jovan Leacock, number 11, is late coming down, and now they give up another big run.
And the Redhawks will let it run out to end the first quarter. So Merriweather touchdown run, and at the end of 1 from here in Bowling Green, Ohio, the Miami Redhawks leading the Bowling Green Falcons 7-0. Back here in Bowling Green, Ohio, get ready to start the second quarter.
He got on.
He did it.
Yeah, but why wear the mask? Because nobody knows who you are now. Take the mask off if you want to get on TV.
Well, look at the ball control in that first quarter, and Merriweather was a big part of that for Miami. Yeah, Bowling Green, 2-3 and outs for their possessions, and if not for the turnover deep in Bowling Green territory, it'd be more than a 7-0 lead, most likely. Now, Dicer uses his feet, gets close to the first down marker near the 37-yard line, caught from behind by Champ Fells.
Dicer again just creating with his legs, but good coverage in the back end by Bowling Green. Forces him to pull the ball down, has nowhere to throw the ball. You see his eyes stay downfield, but he's short of that first down marker. Champ Fells makes that tackle. The knee comes down short of the first down.
Fell a yard short, so Murphy to punt. Hooper back at his own 20. Bounces at the 25, and retreats to the 15. And to the 21-yard line, D.J. Brown with the tackle on special teams for the Redhawks. Well, there have been a lot of great coaches, really, on both sides of this rivalry. You look at the Miami Redhawks. Miami, the cradle of coaches, and some of their notables. Wow, going back, Paul Brown, Eubank, Woody Hayes is here.
Parsegian, Bo Schembechler. I mean, man, legends there.
Incredible names. The cradle of coaches. And Michael Haywood in his second season. So third possession for Bowling Green. Jordan came in motion. Hand off Jeter. Stood up at the 24-yard line. Now for our building a program brought to you by Craftsman and some of the notable Bowling Green coaches. Doy Perry, who the stadium is named after here. Look at that record for Perry back in the 50s and 60s and Don Nealon before going to West Virginia. Hey, don't forget Urban Meyer was here for a couple of years.
Not a lot of people probably know that Urban Meyer was here for a couple of years coaching.
Second down and 7. Running left, Jeter. Nothing there, stood up.
See, Bowling Green wants to run the ball too, but they've got a lot of issues up front. They told us that we were going to see some different things tonight. An inverted wishbone, maybe some wing tee stuff, and they haven't gotten to that yet, but they said that they've got to find a way to create some runs without having to block everybody, because they've had so many issues blocking guys up front with their offensive line. So they wanted to come in and run some option, read some zone read, and not have to block a guy, but just read off of him.
So third down and 6. They go to 4 receivers, 3 on the right side. Under pressure, throw complete. But it's going to be a little shy of the first down, it appears. Deion Nunley bringing down Eugene Cooper.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty close. So you don't see it there, but Cooper out of the slot just runs that in route, just fights enough for a first down. Watch him right here, does a great job just getting up the field, just trying to get every yard that he can get, and just got just enough for a first down.
So they do get their first down of the football game, do the Falcons. Now they do 4 receivers on the right side. The throw goes across the middle to the tight end, and a gain of 10. Shills to Wedge on the tackle, that is, of the tight end Alex Bear. That's Bear, the redshirt freshman, 6'4", 242-pounder.
Yeah, just another way to just try to create something offensively, just try to do some things that no one's seen them do before.
So back-to-back first downs for the Falcons after failing to pick up one in the first quarter. Jeter in the backfield with Shills. Goes across the middle, caught, first catch for Jordan. Came in leading the team with 76 catches. That's a gain of 8. Pat Hinkle, the free safety, on the tackle.
Yeah, Kamar Jordan, they got to get him involved. He's third in the nation in catches. Came in with 76 catches on the year. They really got to get him going. He's one of their main guys, if not the main guy on the whole team. You see him, he's going to go to the top of the of the screen to the field. If they send him to the field, the wide field every time, they'll be working against Brandon Stevens, who's not their best corner on Miami's defense.
Teeter pushes the pile almost all the way to the 45-yard line. Brown and Wedge, part of that pile of the tackle for the Redhawks. You just had to keep those feet moving.
Yeah, but what I was talking about earlier is the way that Miami plays defense. They play a boundary corner and a boundary safety. The boundary corner is DJ Brown. He always goes to the short side of the field, and he's their best cover guy. So if you send your best receiver to the wide side of the field, now you're working against their corner that they don't feel is their best cover guy in Brandon Stevens.
Fake the handoff, the fly sweep, but do give it to Jeter to the 43-yard line. Brandon Stevens, the field quarterback, able to make the tackle there.
And another thing about their defense that's unusual is you see a lot of teams that play boundary corners and field corners, but they also do that with their safeties. And their best safety, Jordan Gaffel, number 22, he goes to the wide side to the field because he's their best tackler and can cover more ground.
Second down and 7. Best drive of the night so far for the Falcons. Chills, and that's caught on that screen pass. Cooper, a yard or two shy perhaps of that first down. Evan Harris, the weak side linebacker, with the stop for the Redhawks.
And that's just a quick screen out there, just another way to get some yards quickly. You see outside Brandon Stevens, number 24, the field corner that we've been talking about. He just runs by the play. They're able to get some positive yards.
Clay Green, 1 of 3 on third down. Third and 2 here. Take the handoff to Wiley, and there, the direct snap, Hopgood. I don't know. Pushed well back, but forward progress gets about a yard. It is going to be fourth down. So you see Shills on the sideline as they lined up Hopgood at quarterback. And here they are at the 37, four down territory for them.
Keep their offense on the field.
They're going to keep Wiley now at the quarterback spot. So Hopgood and now Wiley. Wiley, the sixth-year senior from Detroit. Takes the snap, spins, has the first down, inside the 25, 20. Knocked down at the 12, and Wiley gains 25 on 4th and 1.
And that's a way, and you can see Coach Clausen right there, very happy with that. Anytime they can get a big run, but watch the missed tackle. Make Jarrell Wedge right here, the inside backer missed. Good spin move by Wiley. Now he's able to get outside and down the field. There's Clausen. You know, I liked when we met with them because, you know, he was very honest in their shortcomings and said, hey, we're going to do some different things tonight to try to create some offense. That was a good play for him.
Shields back in the game. He's under center. The tight end Bell goes in motion. Take the handoff to Jeter. Get it to the tight end. Still on his feet. Bear looking for the end zone. Touchdown, Falcons. First touchdown catch of the season for Alex Bear. And there, JC, more of Bowling Green doing the unexpected.
Yeah, some creativity again. You're having trouble, like they've been having trouble all year, just lining up and doing it. Give them credit for being creative here. Just an inside screen, a fake run, and then Bear just determination, just breaks tackles inside and gets to the end zone. That's a big confidence and momentum boost for Bowling Green.
Bear is the holder. And the point after. The Burkhardt ties it. Well, Bear held the point after and gets his first touchdown reception of the season. 8:28 to go till halftime. And it's 7-7 here at Bowling Green. Falcons. 93 total yards, 79 coming on that last drive. But here they are, tied in this football game.
Yeah, and offensively, they still haven't even tried the things that they told us they were going to try. You know, they didn't tell us about the tight end middle screen and things like that, but they've done a great job on that drive to change up some things and create some offense.
Ryan Wright is going to kick it off for Bowling Green. He's the guy that graduated from Michigan. He's going for his graduate's degree here. He's able to kick for NCAA rules. That's fumbled at the 20-yard line, but picked up and pushed out at the 35 is Danny Green. Well, the ESPN College Hoops Tip-Off Marathon is back. That means 24 consecutive hours of live college basketball. 21 games featuring four of the top five men's teams. And to get your first look at both defending national champions, the Duke men and the UConn women, the action kicks off following Monday Night Football on ESPN.
Yeah, if you're a basketball fan and an insomniac, that's the best night of the year right there, because you can watch hoops all night long.
It's quite a way to get it all going.
Yeah.
Let's see how the Redhawks respond now. Dysart throwing off first down and caught. Robinson at the 46-yard line of Bowling Green. A quick pickup of 19. Keith Morgan with the tackle. Redhawks not messing around. Second time they've opened the drive with a long pass tonight.
Yeah, and you see Armand Robinson already four catches tonight. The last two games he only had four total catches, so they're need to get him back involved in this offense. He leads them in catches, 60 catches on the year. He's a guy that can make plays for him.
Dysart, 6 of 6 tonight. 85 yards passing. Rob Merriweather running left and corralled right near the line of scrimmage. Angelo Magnoni. Magnoni, who's a fifth-year senior from Steubenville, Ohio.
Did a good job of keeping outside leverage, not letting Merriweather get to the outside like we've seen him do so many times early in this ball game. Is just started up inside and then bounce it around the corner. That time Magnoni did a great job of staying outside, maintaining that outside leverage.
Four receivers, two to each side for Dysart in the shotgun. And misconnect there. Looked like they were trying to set up the screen pass for Harwell. Perry Stadium, Bowling Green, Ohio. Miami Redhawks getting it done on the ground as well as through the air. Merriweather with a touchdown run. Goes for 18 yards. Give the Redhawks a 7-0 lead. And Alex Baer, a 12-yard touchdown reception. Lunging for the goal line. That has tied it up, and it's 7-7. 7:14 to go till halftime here at Bowling Green. First incompletion for Dysart tonight on that last play, and now timeout called by Miami before the snap. They use their first. So Michael Haywood uses a TO, and we'll step aside as well with 7:14 left till halftime.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by the all-new Volkswagen Jetta. It's great for the price of good. That's Das Auto. And Taco Bell, think outside the bus. Football Primetime, brought to you by the all-new Volkswagen Jetta. It's great for the price of good. That's Das Auto. And Taco Bell, think outside the bun.
Great to have you along tonight. 7-7 game, 7:14 left till halftime. Mark Nathan along with J.C. Pearson and our ESPN crew from Parrott Stadium in Bowling Green, Ohio. 3rd and 10 for the Miami Redhawks from the 46 of Bowling Green. Miami 3 of 5 on third down tonight. Dysart from the shotgun and 5 receivers. And movement on the left side. Going to make it 3rd and 15. And Brandon Brooks moves early.
Bowling Green gave Miami a little dose of their own medicine. A lot of movement up front, trying to create some confusion. And it worked. Brandon Brooks and Matt Kennedy on the left side. The offensive line jumped.
So moves the football back on the Redhawks side of the field. We need to get to the 36 of the Falcons for a first down. Dysart has caught. That's going to be well shy of the first down. Andy Cruz's first catch of the game. He does gain 10. Dwayne Woods, the middle linebacker, with the tackle.
That's exactly what Bowling Green wanted. They dropped back, deep coverage, forced the ball to be thrown short, and then come up, make the tackle, and force a fourth down punt.
Zach Murphy on the punt for the Redhawks. Eugene Cooper standing back at his own 10-yard line. High punt is going to land in the end zone for a touchback. Saturday night, ESPN delivers an SEC showdown as Steve Spurrier returns to the Swamp, where his Gamecocks will take on Urban Meyer and the Florida Gators. College football primetime presented by Hampton Hotels on ESPN Saturday at 7:15 Eastern. Also available online and on your phone. Well, no ball coach going back to Gainesville, where he played and won a Heisman Trophy and a national championship as the head coach in 96. Has only beaten them once, though, as the Gamecocks head coach.
Yeah, a huge game, though. Winner of that game gets into the SEC championship game.
Falcons football from their 20. The clock down to 6. As Shields snaps, hands it off, Jeter flagged down. Jeter makes a nice move, cuts to the 30, spins, ankle tackled at the 35, and may be coming back. Jason Sims, the tackle for the Redhawks.
Penalty flag in the play.
Here's our referee, Stan Evans, with the call. Each team has been penalized twice so far tonight. Someone had to be penalized the third time.
The first foul, holding. Offense.
Well, a couple of penalties there, both against the Falcons. And that run is coming back. Let's take a look at the SEC Eastern Division standings of that matchup coming up between the Gators and Gamecocks.
See, number 22 versus number 23, winner take all to get to the championship game.
One of the bottom three teams in that East have scuffled this year.
Put it mildly, huh?
Didn't seem nice. So back to the 10-yard line for the Falcons. Swiss takes the low snap, rolls right, throws. Screen caught at the 12-yard line, and bouncing forward to the 14 is Jordan Harris. Tackle for Miami.
We talked about the issues up front, their offensive line, but they've done a pretty good job so far handling all of the chaos that Miami tries to create defensively by a lot of different personnel, bringing different people from different areas and things. They've done a good job so far protecting Shield,
which has been a big issue earlier in the season. Shields again throwing right. The catch made at the 20. Pat Hinkle hitting Jordan as soon as he made the catch. A minimal gain. It'll be third down and 9. With the chills.
Starting to heat up.
Yes.
Starting to get comfortable back there early in the game. We saw that, you know, he's kind of worried about the pressure and if his line was going to pick up the right guys, but it's like he's confident now and comfortable back there.
Tyrone Crowdy in motion. Shields, here comes the pressure, steps up. He's going to run. He's got a chance to get the first down with his legs. Will not, though, as he is undercut by Demetrius Quarles. The freshman got it before he could get to the 30. He needed to get just beyond the 30 for the first down.
Yeah, but if he just runs straight, he has the first down easily. He runs into the tackler. You can see does a good job just pulling the ball down. Now just get up the field. He's looking at the tackler the whole way and trying to shield himself from the hit. Now he's short of the first down.
He's short of Quarles' line to the quarterback running towards him there.
Yeah, and that's what Coach Clawson is telling him. Get up the field. Get up the field. All you needed was another yard.
Back to receive for Miami, number 13, DeMarco Payne.
DeMarco Payne back at his old 30-yard line. It's picked up. He can't get the punt off right, and it's recovered by Miami at the 15. Jason Sims grabbing it there for the Redhawks. A low snap and right. Never able to get the punt off.
Yeah, you can see it's bad right from the start. And now this is not roughing the punter at all. Once the ball hits the ground, then the punter's live now. That's why there's no point in trying to block the punt. Just go and blow up the punter. That's exactly what they did right there. Just a huge turnover by Bowling Green.
Sims hit the punter. Mark recovered. Called in the long snapper there. So the Redhawks take over at the 15-yard line. And keeping it. Dicer inside the one. How about that play call on first down? The quarterback keeper, Zach Dicer, runs for 14.
Yeah, good just zone read play. And Dicer reads that in, who crashes down hard. He just keeps it off the edge, makes one guy miss. Well, this is something that he hasn't done a whole lot of this year. Doesn't run the ball a lot, although he's very capable.
So first and goal from the one. Keeping it again, and he's not going to get in. Pushed back for a loss, or maybe with forward progress, no gain. Keith Morgan helping out on the tackle along with Champ Fells.
The red zone numbers for Miami on the year. They've been down there 28 times and only 12 touchdowns. That's not good enough. They want at least 50% touchdowns when you get in the red zone. Especially when you get down this close, you got to be able to punch it in.
Merriweather, the back. Dicer. Nada again. Ball came loose, but he was down. For three straight times, number 4 keeping it.
Yeah, and watch Dwayne Woods, number 5. The inside backer does a good job of reading and stepping up right there, just meeting Dicer right on the edge. Keeps him out of the end zone. Watch again. Watch number 5 just show up right off the edge. Does a great job doesn't wrap up and make the tackle, but makes the initial hit.
So from first and goal from the one, now third and goal from the one. They go to the eye with Justin Sims. Dotting it for Merriweather, running left. Dysart trying to turn the corner. Oh, he got stuck, lost the football. No, they say he got in. Touchdown. Well, Dysart paid the price. He took a lick, but apparently got in for six, and Miami retakes the lead.
Yeah, he's feeling it there, too. He took a big shot in the chest trying to extend the ball. You got to lower your pads here. You can't just expose your chest. Watch him try to stick the ball out. It takes a huge shot in the chest. The ball comes out. They get the touchdown, but you don't want your quarterback taking that shot right there. You got to drop your pads.
That was Adrian Spencer, the quarterback, who came up and hit him. So four straight running plays for Dysart, as it turned out. And they are going to review this.
Yeah, you're going to see if he got the ball across the line.
Looks like don't know from that look.
Again, tries to extend it right here. Takes that big shot and the ball comes out. I don't think the ball right there ever crossed the plane of the end zone.
Yeah, the ball's on the backside. But then Spencer for a moment, and then it's loose.
But I think Miami recovered the ball. See, there's no question right there by the ref up top. He calls touchdown right away.
Now, ruling on the field touchdown, do we know for sure that Miami recovered in that pile?
I'm not sure that's what they're going to be looking at.
Because if it's ruled through video evidence that he did not get in.
And that's Dysart there, a little shaken up. You see everybody around him talking to him because he takes this shot. Watch him try to extend the ball, exposes his chest. And it's tough. Does he have possession of the ball still when it crosses the plane of the end zone? It's tough to tell right there, because as soon as he takes that shot, that ball starts to come out. It's hard to tell from that angle.
It's going to be very tough from that angle to overturn it, but just my gut feeling from looking at it, I don't think he got the ball across the goal line before it came loose. But it's going to be tough to overturn it because of the angle that we see there. There's not going to be the indisputable video evidence. But we thought that on the first one on the pylon with the left foot of Merriweather, and it turned into a touchdown. So you see what Tom Workman, the booth replay official, decides on this one.
Obviously, as long as it's taking, it's not as clear cut up top either.
Just a minute 47 left till halftime. Big call coming right here.
There's a call on the field. Stands up, call. Touchdown.
Well, and you notice the terminology call stand. Let's say confirm, so there was not enough video evidence to overturn the call on the field. Well, a touchdown run for Dysart. Cook for the point after, and it's 14-7 Red Hawks. So the 1 yard touchdown run for Dysart, his first rushing TD. 1:47 to go till halftime.
Fiesta, Orange, Sugar, and the Tostitos BCS National Championship Game. ESPN, the BCS lives here.
14-7, Red Hawks leading the Falcons. So Miami taking advantage of the short field after the bad punt snap from Bowling Green. Celebrating its sixth year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick to date. Allstate has contributed more than $2.3 million in scholarship money.
And the return for the Falcons, number 24, Boo Gates, and number 85, Ron Conti.
Well, the Red Hawks lead it by 7, 1:47 to go. Ball falling off the tee for Seth Phillip. Really not any wind to speak of here tonight on a crisp fall night in Northwest Ohio. Boo-Boo Gates, Tyrone Pronti back deep for the Falcons. Gates watches it go out of bounds, and Falcons are going to start from the 40. Let's get another studio update. Here's Ryan Burr. Thanks very much. Okay, he mentioned Cam Newton again. You want to go after it? You want to hold off a little while longer?
As he said, there are allegations right now, and until more comes out, and I think you need some proof. Anybody can put anything out there. I think they've got to get a little more proof, and they've been investigating it since January. I don't know why it's taken so long.
Ryan and Trevor Battis have more on that at the half. The pass completed to Eugene Cooper. Flag comes out. Jordan Gafford tackle there for Miami. Sort out the penalty marker here.
You got to wonder if that's going to affect Auburn, though, in their game this weekend against Georgia. So many distractions. And how's Cam Newton going to play?
Offensive pass interference.
Lawson not very happy about that. He's been on the referees all night. There's something going on down there he's not happy about. Obviously, that offensive pass interference is one, but he's been in their ear quite a bit.
First and 25, pushing the ball back to the Falcons 25-yard line. Shows hands off, Jeter. Runs right. Needs a couple. Jason Sims, the tackle. 5 yards there for Jeter, who came in averaging 63 yards per game, leading the Falcons. Senior from Miami. That's Miami, Florida. Senior high school. Had a couple of touchdowns in the Humanitarian Bowl for Bowling Green. Idaho last year. To the 32. Jeter tackled by Nudley and Wedge. Now you're 40 seconds and counting.
And if you're Miami, why not use a timeout here and see if you can stop them with the issue that they just had with their punt unit? You might get a chance at another score, but looks like both teams are content to just let the clock run out.
Two timeouts left. For each team, for that matter.
Third and 18. Why not use a timeout, stop the clock, and
make them
force them, make them get a stop and force them to bring their punt unit back on.
So the play clock down to 4.
I don't know if that's a good decision there.
So we'll take a timeout with just 5 seconds to go until halftime. And a 7-point game. Third down at 18. Miami electing not to use either of their two remaining timeouts. On third and long here now for Bowling Green, who a running play can run out the clock, most likely to not here in this first half. And Jeter looks like he'll do just that. Stopped by C.J. Martin, and Miami will go to the locker room, leading by 14-7 here at the intermission. Now let's go to Ryan Burr in the studio with the college football halftime report.
ESPN3.com College Football Halftime Report is brought to you by Farmers Insurance. We are insurance. We are farmers.
Welcome to the ESPN3.com Halftime Report brought to you by Farmers Insurance. I'm Cassidy Hubbard alongside Christian Fourier. We now welcome in ESPN College Football Insider Joe Shad, who has been tracking the allegations surrounding Cam Newton. Joe, what's the latest that you've been hearing involving this story?
Well, Cassidy, I spoke to two people who recruit for Mississippi State and were involved in the recruiting process of Cam Newton, who, of course, we know went to Auburn. And those two individuals told me that they relayed conversations that they had, two separate conversations, one with Cam Newton, one with his father, Cecil, to the SEC office. And here's what they allegedly said. Part one, Cecil Newton allegedly said that it would take, quote, more than a scholarship to get his son onto campus in Starkville. After Cam Newton changed his commitment from Mississippi State to Auburn, Cam Newton allegedly had a conversation with a Mississippi State recruiter, upon which he said he wished he could go to Mississippi State, but, quote, the money was too much. These allegations, of course, are currently being investigated by the NCAA.
Well, supposedly the SEC has known about these allegations since January. So where are things now involving investigation from either the SEC and or the NCAA?
Well, certainly, Cassidy, the NCAA's investigation is picking up steam. Cecil Newton himself has acknowledged that he has turned over documents and bank records to the NCAA. The NCAA has been gathering evidence, and it's my understanding that since January, there has been more evidence, some of which has been reported at ESPN.com, convincing the NCAA that they need to investigate this thoroughly and that perhaps they could use the benefit and assistance of state and federal government authorities. And those groups, I'm told, would be more than willing to help the NCAA in a cooperative investigative effort.
Well, last week, the allegations pertained to Newton's recruitment to Mississippi State, but these are the first allegations directly involving Auburn. How much are they risking by continuing to play Cam Newton?
Yeah, you know, reportedly, Auburn was at least made aware of the fact that there might be an issue prior to the season, and clearly they moved forward playing Cam Newton. Now, it's been a great success. He's the leader for the Heisman Trophy. Auburn is undefeated. They're on the verge of the SEC championship and a national championship. But, Cassidy, there's no question that that is all at risk. If it is determined in a few months, in a few years, remember, Reggie Bush investigation took 5 years, that Cam Newton should have been ruled ineligible, then yes, of course, what Auburn is risking, despite their strong public support of Cam Newton, is a bunch of victories, potentially the Heisman Trophy, and potentially championships.
Well, you mentioned Cam Newton's the front runner in the Heisman in this post-Reggie Bush era. How are these allegations going to affect the voting in December?
Yeah, well, I think that it's unlikely that the NCAA's investigation will be wrapped up by the time Heisman Trophy voters fill out their ballots. So those voters are going to be dealing with a moral dilemma, I suppose, and certainly with the cloud of Reggie Bush still hanging over their head, that in their memory. But, you know, it could very well have an impact on their decision. Look, Cam Newton is clearly, without a doubt, been the most outstanding player in college football this season. But these allegations and things that occurred back in Florida could certainly be held against him by Heisman voters.
Well, that's ESPN insider Joe Shad. Thanks, Joe, for the latest on this developing story. Make sure to stay tuned to ESPN. Now, Christian, what is your take on all these allegations surrounding Cam Newton?
I tell you what, my first take when I heard about this was, wow, Somebody does not want this kid to win the Heisman Trophy. Now, would we really be hearing about this if he wasn't on the number two team in the nation and playing as well as he is? The second thing is how quickly your perception can change of somebody. Now, we're talking about a guy that was, transcending his position, and he had this Magic Johnson smile, and now he's a guy with skeletons in his closet. Now, if you're thinking about the Heisman, and we're talking Heisman, and you have a vote for the Heisman Trophy, you got to assume that there's a huge red flag next to Cam's name. Now, whether it's warranted or not is remained to be unseen. But since you want your vote to count, you got to think about what happened with Reggie Bush. Now, you do not want to give your vote to somebody when 5 years later have that vote not even exist. It's got to be something that you know is going to go through time and last. So I know a lot of voters are going to be thinking about this. Now, whether it's warranted or not, I'm not sure. But for right now, it's on everybody's mind.
Well, and it also should be interesting to see how Newton and the entire team responds to these distractions surrounding him. It's not just Newton being distracted by all this. The team is being asked in the locker room what's going on with this. And they have a big game this Saturday against Georgia where they can lock up the SEC West title.
Yeah, and what they need to do as a team is just worry about what they can control. And they have nothing to do with what's going on outside of their locker room. So they need to forget about it and focus on the game at hand.
Again, stay tuned to ESPN for the latest on this developing story. Coming up after the break, BCS expert Brad Edwards joins us to try to help us make sense of what's going on in BCS. Stick around. You're watching the ESPN3.com Halftime Report presented by Farmers Insurance.
Monday, done with work, but it hasn't been a cakewalk. First, you stuck your foot in your mouth.
Big day.
Big day.
And then a sale went south. But Monday means Monday Night Football, where you're the employee of the month for a day.
Welcome back. Taking a look at the current BCS standings, Oregon is at the top spot for the second straight week, but the margin is a little bit smaller between them and Auburn. TCU is holding strong in that number three spot. Boise State at four, despite the fact that they won 42-7 against Hawaii Saturday. And LSU getting in the top five after knocking off the defending champs. They're the highest-ranked one-loss team, which brings up a question that seems to be popping up every week. We are now joined by our BCS expert, Brad Edwards, to help answer this question, among others. Last week, we talked about if Alabama were to win out, then there should be little argument to say that they should be in the BCS championship game over an undefeated non-AQ team. But let's say if Auburn were to lose a game, is it as easy an argument to say that they should be in a BCS championship game over, say, TCU?
Yeah, I don't think Auburn's a slam dunk if they lose, but they are a team that you have to consider as a threat to TCU if they drop one. Now, if Auburn loses, in order to stay in the race, I think the loss would have to be at Alabama. So they have to beat Georgia this week, clinch the SEC West, assure themselves of a spot in that SEC title game. If they lose to Alabama, the voters aren't going to kill them for that. That's a tough place to play. I'm not sure there are any teams out there that are going to go into Tuscaloosa and win. And then if they can follow that up with an impressive win in the SEC championship, have that SEC title on their resumes, Then the voters have a choice to make. You know, is a one-loss SEC team with as many quality wins as Auburn has more deserving than a team like a TCU? And, if you look at the computer element of it, Auburn with a loss will be ranked up there just as high as TCU and Boise State in those computers. The question is, would the voters put them ahead? And that's something that we really won't know. There are almost 200 people who vote in those two polls. And I'm not about to try to get in their minds and predict what they're going to do. My gut feeling is that Auburn's a little bit of a long shot in that situation, but you never know because there are definitely people out there that don't think that a team like TCU with that schedule deserves a shot to play. So we'd have to find out on December 5th.
Well, of course, this debate will be deemed useless if Auburn and Oregon make it into the national championship game and win out. So let's take a look at how the BCS Bowls would shape up if they were decided today. Oregon and Auburn, of course, in the title game. LSU and Ohio State would be in the Sugar Bowl. Virginia Tech, the lone ACC rep, and Oklahoma State in the Orange. Nebraska and probable Big East champ Pitt in the Tostitos Bowl. And Wisconsin and TCU in the Rose Bowl, given that Oregon is projected to be in the title game. The highest non-AQ team would get the Rose Bowl bid. So when looking at this, one team missing.
It was Boise State. I look at this BCS projections, and here's a team like Boise State who started this whole catalyst about a non-AQ team being in a championship game. Now it looks like, as it ended right now, they wouldn't even be in a BCS bowl. Is it possible? that this could happen?
Yeah, it is possible for sure. Now, one thing that needs to be pointed out in that graphic, it said at the top on the title, if the season ended today, and the season most certainly does not end today. And one of the keys there is that Oklahoma State, the team that was projected as an at-large in the Orange Bowl, right now is in that spot because they have only one loss. But if you look at the Big 12, there's not a chance for there to be any team other than the champion with a single loss. Everybody else will have at least two losses, which makes the decision for the Orange Bowl a little bit more difficult. You know, and if you're breaking it down to undefeated Boise State, ranked 3 or 4 in the final BCS standings, versus a 2 or 3 loss Big 12 team, and theoretically that could be a team like a Nebraska or an Oklahoma with a big name and a ton of fans, maybe ranked down around double digits in the BCS. What choice do you make? And you know, one of the things that the bowls always have to consider is ticket sales. And Boise is coming from the far reaches of the other side of the country, the other corner of the country. And what's the best for ticket sales? And it's a tough choice. What's the best PR move? What's the best for business? But that's what they would have to decide.
Well, what about a team like Stanford, a Big Six team? They could possibly go 11-1. What are their possibilities of Stanford being left out of the BCS bowl games?
You know, Stanford's another team that, despite having a great season and probably having a pretty high ranking at the end of the year, could easily get left out of this thing. Now, part of the reason Stanford get left out, in fact, a big part of it, is that this year, if the Pac-10 champion or the Big Ten champion, for that matter, vacates the Rose Bowl to play for the national title, instead of them being able to plug in a second Pac-10 team like they normally would if Oregon is in that national title game, this year that spot has to go to a non-AQ team, which is why you saw TCU there on the projection. So where else could Stanford go? The Sugar Bowl would have a chance to take them. I don't think the Sugar Bowl would make that move, which means that Stanford is in that argument or that discussion with Boise State and another team from the Big 12. And the reality is, for Stanford, that they're a private school. They have a smaller fan base. They're not going to bring a lot of fans across the country to sit in the seats there at the Orange Bowl. And so what it really comes down to that a lot of people confuse when it comes to the BCS is that this is a business. Outside of that national championship game, the other four bowls are businesses that are trying to make money, and you make money by selling tickets, putting people in those seats, and Stanford is not going to sell a lot of tickets. And that's why even though they might be the most deserving team of being in there, they're probably not going to be in there unless Oregon is playing TCU for the national title. Stanford's probably going to be out of the BCS.
Well, we're getting close to the final stretch here. Regardless who makes it to the title game and the rest of the BCS bowls, it's definitely been a fun year debating who should be. That's BCS expert Brad Edwards. Thanks for joining us.
It's not over yet.
Yeah, it's not over. Well, after the break, we'll get you ready for the weekend by breaking down the best games to watch. Stick around.
Our family was expanding rapidly, and my car was worn out, so we got the 97 Camry.
When I was 16, I got the Camry, and I drove it for 9 years.
Then when I turned 16, I was passed down the Camry. I was like, yes!
And then we just got a Camry Hybrid. It's just such a perfect, practical car.
I'm hoping to probably get the new Camry Hybrid.
Share your Toyota story on Facebook.com/Toyota.
Welcome to Sports Nation on ESPN3.com, brought to you by Toyota. I'm Colin Cowherd. Today's poll question is, who is the Toyota Quality Performer of the Week? Now, Edwin Baker at Michigan State, nice player. Andy Dalton, TCU, they just keep bludgeoning teams. Roy Roundtree, Michigan would rather run than throw, but he's a good receiver. TJ Yates at Carolina. Log on to SportsNation.com, vote. Join us Saturdays on ESPN3.com to see the results. Back to you, Cassidy.
Welcome back. Taking a look at some of the upcoming games you can find right here on ESPN3.com. Indiana takes on number 7 Wisconsin this Saturday at noon. Wisconsin needs to keep winning to stay in the hunt for the Big Ten title. And Alabama, coming off their loss to LSU, faces Dan Mullen and Mississippi State, who would have thought these two teams would have the same record at this point in the season. Remember, you can find all these games and much, much more on ESPN3.com. Christian, you saw there are a lot of great games this weekend, but what are some you're looking forward to the most?
Well, the one I'm looking forward to the most is for the SEC East Championship. We're talking about South Carolina taking on Florida. Now, Steve Spurrier, big loss last week, so he's going to have to circle the wagons, and he has not won in Gainesville. They're 0-12, and since the last time they played Alabama, Alabama was ranked number one, they're 2-2. Heavy dose of Marcus Lattimore as the keys to free up Steven Garcia to make those big throws. How about Joe Paul getting 400 last week? Dramatic fashion, too. Sophomore quarterback Matt McLuhan threw four TDs in a comeback win versus Northwestern, but he's going against Ohio State defense that has 15 interceptions. The key for the Buckeyes is balance on offense. That means the arms of Terrell Pryor and the legs of Dan Boom Heron. How about Texas A&M at Baylor? Texas A&M is ranked. A lot of chance of the Wrecking Crew. That's the big old defense that was big in the 80s and 90s. Why? They held the Sooners to 19 points, three goal line stances. A lot of that had to do with the quarterback play of Ryan Tannehill. And that was his third start. If the Texas A&M can lean on their quarterback and play that great defense that they've been playing all year, they're still alive in the Big 12 South.
The Big 12 South has been just crazy this year, hasn't it? Well, that's a wrap on the ESPN3.com halftime show brought to you by Farmers Insurance. On behalf of Christian and I and our entire team here at ESPN3, we would like to extend our sincerest appreciation to all the veterans and the active men and women serving in the armed forces. Thank you for all that you do. For Christian Fourier, I'm Cassidy Hubbard. Let's now send you out to the second half.
getting ready for the start of the second half from here at Bowling Green, Ohio, with Miami leading by a score of 14-7. It's terrific to have you along with us tonight on this Wednesday from Northwest Ohio. Mark Daly along with J.C. Pearson. We are looking fallish, my man. This is good football weather.
It's a little chilly out here tonight, man.
Well, let's get to our Fidelity game track. And really, it's one of the big stories has been the ground game for both of these teams and the fact that they have struggled in running the football this year. Five rushing touchdowns all season for Miami coming in to get two in the first half.
Yeah, they do. And Merriweather did a great job early in the half getting the running game going. They're already over 100 yards. Now, they got some help here with the bad snap by Bowling Green, but then they were able to punch it in. Dysert running around the edge just gets the ball over the goal line there, and that's the first rushing touchdown of the year for Miami by someone other than Merriweather.
So the Falcons, their head coach Dave Clawson, if not for the bad snap on the punt, maybe looking at a tie score here, 7-7. But again, Miami also, their first possession of the football game, marched down the field, got inside the 20, and fumbled it themselves. So yeah, they might be thinking, hey, we should be up a couple of touchdowns here.
Yeah, but when you're Bowling Green and you're trying to fight for a win, you haven't had very many wins on the year, you can't afford to have those kinds of mistakes with just a snap error that leads to, you know, obviously turning the ball over and 7 points for the opponent.
Well, the Falcons are going to get the football to begin the second half. And Boo Boo Gates finds a hole, 40. Great return all the way out to the 44-yard line before Justin Bowers brings him down. Take a look at the first half numbers. Look at the rushing yards and passing yards, really balanced for each team in Miami of Ohio, just more total yards, almost double.
But the rushing yards coming in, they were the second worst rushing team in the entire country, only averaging 63 yards a game, and they're already at 106, so they're getting it done on the ground.
Jeter will be the back for Bowling Green as they have very good starting field position to begin the second half from their own 44-yard line. Cooper in motion. Pick the fly sweep to him. Give it to Jeter. Bounces off the pile, but gets pushed back. If they give him forward progress, maybe gets a yard or to the line of scrimmage. Give him a yard for Willie Jeter.
Man, I'm still waiting for Bowling Green to break out the wing tee and the inverted wishbone. All those things that we talked about in our production meeting with Coach Clawson and the offensive coordinator, Warren Ruggiero. Waiting for them to bring all that stuff out.
We have a Bowling Green player down, and it is, looks like the tight end, Nick Reakey. Having the right leg worked on, the fifth-year senior Reakey from Crystal Lake, Illinois.
See if we can see it, number 44 right there on the left side of your screen, just one of his own guys. Just rolled him up. Watch number 44 right there. See right there. Again, one of his own guys just rolls him up. And
Scott Lewis. Held to his feet.
Good sign there.
Thank you. Played quarterback in high school. Big kid, 6'4", 262 pounds. So walking off under his own power with a little bit of a limp in that giddy up. Well, the Falcons taking that time to huddle with their head coach Dave Lawson. Offensive coordinator Warren Ruggiero, who was at Kansas State as a quarterback coach in 2008. Coach Josh Freeman, who was the 17th overall pick of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, really having a breakout season this year.
Playing very well down there for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Guy from the Kansas City area, Grandview High School, watched him play growing up, know his father very well. Very happy for that young man.
Second down at 10. Shills That ball deflected and is incomplete. I believe they were trying to set up a screen for Jeter. That hit a couple of bodies and bounced around, and only great fortune they didn't lose the football there.
Yeah, man, that's a dangerous throw there. You got to throw that one in the ground. You see that it's not going to go anywhere. You just got to ground this ball. Just throw it at his feet. You can see he just tries to force it in there. Ball got tipped around. Lucky for him that it didn't get picked off.
Third and 10, and Bowling Green only one of six on third down tonight. Shields, big rush, and he takes a seat back at the 36-yard line. Anthony Kokel was one among a host of white shirts to get to him.
And there's the pressure that we talked about the whole first half. Miami tries to create a lot of confusion, a lot of movement. You'll see him moving around up front, and now they just bring everybody. Bowling Green doesn't have enough guys to block. They come up with the big sack on third down.
Now remember the last punt attempt, the bad snap, but this time a good snap. Right, and Payne coming towards the near side. That ball, did it hit a Redskin? Bowling Green has it at the 24-yard line of Miami. They have bounced off Deion Nunley. And a big turnover gives it back to Bowling Green.
See that ball right there? Deion Nunley just hustling down, trying to block. And that's where that Peter call has to come in. You got to tell him to get away. The ball is coming to you because he's down there trying to block for you, and the ball hits him right in the back.
Cooper Gates on the recovery for Bowling Green. So now they're at the 24-yard line of Miami, trailing by seven here early in this third quarter. Jordan. Team in motion for a few steps. Jeter straight ahead to near the 21-yard line. C.J. Martin, strong side linebacker on the tackle.
You know, they've struggled running the ball all year. We talked about Miami's struggle, but Bowling Green is the worst rushing team in the country, only 62 yards a game. But Willie Jeter, they've got to try to get him to the edge a little more. He's a small guy. 5'7", 176 pounds, and they're trying to run him inside a little too much. He's not a big, strong guy. Let him use his speed and his quickness and try to get to the edge.
Shields with a little more time, a lot more time this time. The catch at the 12, and then the stick made. Did not hang on to it. Gafford put the hit on Pronti.
This is a ball that Pronti's got to catch. Just coming across the middle. You know you're going to take a shot anyway. You got to catch that ball, and that's a big first down for you. You know you're going to get a hit anyway. You see him look up right at the end, take his eyes off the ball and looking for a defender. Just doesn't bring the catch in.
Great personnel change by the Miami defense. It's third and seven. With a shovel pass and quickly swarmed. Loose football. Did Jeter give it back up? Wedge and Harris quickly swarmed him after the shovel pass. No signal, so it looks like it will stay with Bowling Green, but they're going to be back at the 25. And decision time on what they want to do here.
See, he's down clearly before the ball comes out. But that's one of those plays where they just want to read the defensive end and try to get a play inside. That's one of those guys that they want to not have to block and just make a read off of. The problem is they didn't block the other guys inside, Jordan Brown and the other tackle.
Kyle Burkhart, a 44-yard attempt. This will not count. Went wide left regardless. Timeout was called by Bowling Green. Pay clock was running down. So Bowling Green takes a timeout. We'll step aside. 12:05 to play in this third quarter, and the Burkhart field goal when we come back. 7. Miami leading, 12:05 to go in this third quarter. And the reason Bowling Green elected to take a timeout, you see the 11th player coming on the field there.
And then you see Coach Clausen running down the sideline. He's going to take the timeout and immediately go out to the field. You don't want to be that young man that was out there late.
This is Kyle Burkhardt, who as of last week now handling the field goals and point after attempts. 1 for 1 this year. His only attempt came from 34 yards. This is a 43-yard attempt. It's low and does not have the distance. May have been tipped there by Austin Brown. The reason it did not make it. And it remains 14-7 Miami.
Austin Brown has blocked 4 kicks. The last couple of years, number 90 does a great job of just penetrating and getting his arms up there.
You got that right arm up there. Yeah. Got a piece of that.
Yeah, that's something he's done a great job of over the last couple of years.
So Bowling Green unable to take advantage of the Miami turnover on special teams. And the Redhawks take over at their own 25-yard line. Mayweather met in the backfield by Angelo Magnoni for a loss. Saturday afternoon, ABC and ESPN deliver a huge game of the Big Ten. Joe Pye going for win number 401. Goes against the Ohio State Buckeyes. Some parts of the nation will see Texas Tech, Oklahoma, or Virginia Tech, North Carolina. Go to ESPN.com and search maps to find your game. College football presented by Kay Jewelers on ABC or ESPN Saturday at 3:30 Eastern. You and I will have the opportunity to call the Virginia Tech North Carolina game. Looking forward to that one.
Yeah, should be a great game. How about Penn State making a switch at quarterback?
Going to the far side, incomplete. Harwell. The intended receiver over there was Robinson. Tyron Taylor of Virginia Tech having another nice year, of course, with the feet and the arm.
Yeah, and playing now like people expected him to play. After those first couple of losses to open the season, I think people kind of forgot about Tyrod Taylor, and he's come back the last 7 weeks, all wins, and playing very, very well. So looking forward to seeing him play on Saturday.
David Yates is under the radar for North Carolina. Oh, great year.
With all the things that they've gone through this year, T.J. Yates has played well, and Butch Davis, he's got to be in some consideration for Coach of the Year, huh?
Absolutely. 3rd and 12. Weaving through traffic, Merriweather to the 26. Dwayne Woods on the stop. But just a gain of 3, and it's going to be 4th down. It'll be a rare 3 and out tonight for the Miami offense. Cooper back at the 36-yard line to receive a Zach Murphy punt. Got it away, and it bounces inside the 40. They'll let it roll. Wiley almost got a piece of that Murphy punt. Falcons ball when we come back to Bowling Green.
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Lexus. This is the pursuit of tomorrow. This is the pursuit of perfection. And KFC. Try KFC's new Doubleicious chicken sandwich on a sweet Hawaiian bun. So good.
A little fog has descended here at Perry Stadium. ...14-7, Miami leading Bowling Green, 10:31 to go in this third quarter. It's not exactly the pea soup of Bears-Eagles.
Not yet. It's rolling in, though.
Falcons ball from their own 31-yard line. Play fake, rolling right, Shills. Complete to Calvin Wiley. For a gain of a couple, Jordan Gaffer, the strong safety, had the coverage on him.
You know, where's Kamar Jordan? They've got to get the ball to Kamar Jordan. He's third in the nation in catches right now coming into this game. It's been pretty quiet. I think you got to get him opportunities. You got to try to throw it. He's your main guy. You're going away from him.
Three catches tonight for Jordan for a total of 19 yards. Second down at 8. Hopko to the backfield. The Shills throws across the middle, threads it complete to midfield. Helmet gets ripped off. Tyrone Pronti, the fifth-year senior from Maple Heights, Ohio, on the catch. He gains 20. Then lost his hat.
Yeah, this is the route that we saw him drop earlier in this game, just that in route from the slot position. This time, Shields puts it right on his numbers, able to make the catch. And trying to rip that ball out, they just rip his helmet off. You got to know when to get down at some point. You're not getting out of that one.
Fly sweep, Wiley. Austin Brown sniffed it out and they lost a yard.
Yeah, it just took too long. The timing was way off on that jet sweep. He had to hold the ball out there. And like, where are you? By the time he got there, Austin Brown was able to make the tackle. But watch the timing. Watch how long he had to hold the ball out there and just wait for him to get there. And by that time, Austin Brown penetrates enough to make that tackle for a loss.
Good in motion. Pressure on, dumped off on a screen pass, caught 40, 35 yard line, and then tackled from behind by Austin Brown. Eugene Cooper on the catch. Brown to get there to make the stop.
That's the screen game that's a huge part of their offense. You're going to see number 12 just start outside, come right back under on the screen, and is able to just catch the ball and get down the field. But that's a huge package in their offensive scheme, is the screens to running backs, wide receivers, tight ends. We saw the tight end middle screen for a touchdown in the first half.
Jarrell Wedge hit the pressure on Shills, who completed that pass. First down after the 34 Miami, and that's incomplete. Looking for Jordan Nunnally with the coverage. Big time college football action continues all week on ESPN and ESPN2. First on ESPN Thursday night, 7:30 Eastern tomorrow. Big East leader Pittsburgh takes on UConn. And then on ESPN2 Friday night at 9 Eastern, Kellen Moore and number 4 Boise State take on Idaho. Go to ESPN.com for more information. Here's Kellen Moore in your Heisman ballot right now.
He's got to be up there. Huh? You got to think right now.
Top three anyway,
Newton,
right? Hey,
definitely. Cam Newton, LaMichael James, Kellen Moore.
Incomplete. Looking for their running back, Jeter. Numbers on Kellen Moore. Look at that impressive completion percentage. Tied for second in the Football Bowl subdivision. 21 touchdown passes, only 4 picks.
No question, another great year, and I think an even bigger stat than any of those is his one loss record as a starter. pretty impressive when you put that up there.
Third down and 10. Shields looking left the whole way, and the pass is high and incomplete.
for Adrian Hodges. Well, looking at a very long field goal here of close to 50 yards. If they were to choose to kick one here. Fourth and 10 from the 34.
Which they're not choosing to do.
Right. So they go for it on fourth down. One of one on fourth down tonight. I remember earlier, Wiley on fourth and one had a long run. And that's batted down, incomplete. Wedge knocked it down, and Miami will take over on downs. Just under 8 minutes to go in this third quarter. The Redhawks will have the football and a 7-point lead when we come back to Bowling Green. Serious.
Every time we go away and come back, it's a little foggier and foggier.
Miami takes over on downs. We're on 34. They lead 14-7. We're 8 minutes to go in the third quarter. Kaiser from the gun. Caught on the far side. Nope, incomplete. At the 40-yard line intended for Andy Cruz.
I wonder if the fog down there is affecting the vision. I mean, this is a play and a pass that should be caught. Cruz at the top of the screen just hits him right between the numbers, and you see him looking at his hands. They're still there. Just got to use it.
Flags fly. False start. On the Redhawks. And Josh Harvey, the right tackle. Josh Harvey out of Hickman High School in Columbia, Missouri. So second down at 15. Caught at the 40-yard line. About 4 yards shy of the first down, Armand Robinson. Well, we mentioned at the top of the show the mud game here 4 years ago, November 15th.
when this was a natural grass field, it was changed the following year. Kokel had the touchdown throw and the Bowling Green field goal attempt near the end that would have won it, affected by the conditions, and the Redhawks won it 9-7. This field went to field turf the next year. So we had the mud game 4 years ago. Are we going to call this the fog game here?
And those games are not fun to play in when it's cold. When it's warm, it's okay to play in all that mud and everything, but when it's cold, it's miserable.
Caught near midfield. That's Nick Harwell. Henry Davis on the coverage. And a first down for the Redhawks.
Nick Harwell's been kind of quiet. He was one of the hottest receivers in the country coming into the game. You can see just pushes up the field, runs that out route, and ball's right on the money. Harwell went to the prep school at Air Force last year. He came and doing really well right here at Miami.
And the draw, Merriweather. Knocked down across the 45-yard line. Picks up 7 yards there from Merriweather, the senior out of the St. Louis suburb of Florissant, Missouri.
And you know, we're talking about Harwell and been one of the hottest receivers the last few games, and we asked why. You know, number one is because he's been getting a lot of single coverage, but the other thing is he's taking care of himself better off the field, getting some rest. He was enjoying college life a little too much coming from the prep school at Air Force. They had a hard time keeping him awake at those early morning practices. Now that they got him on track, now he's starting to play well.
Less nightlife has meant more highlights on the football field for Nick Harwell in recent weeks. Merriweather to the 36-yard line, and another first down for the Redhawks. Champ Fells, the fifth-year senior from Florida, the tackle for the Falcons.
And that right there has really been the key for Miami, the ability to run the ball tonight. We've been talking about how coming in, they were one of the worst in the country, second worst running the ball, but they really felt like tonight they could get it done because Bowling Green defensively is giving up 208 yards a game rushing it. Miami's winning that battle right now.
Here in the fog in Bowling Green, Ohio, first down, clock running under 5.5 minutes left, third quarter. And a handoff running back to the left side of the field now, inside the 25-yard line. Harwell started right, went back left. Laycock on the tackle. Well, it's gotten thick enough. I would think a long pass would be difficult to pick up. I don't think down on the field anything in the short passing game is going to be too terribly effective right now, do you?
No, and right now I think Miami's not even thinking about really throwing the ball down the field with the way they're running it right now, milking time off the clock. But you got to give their offensive line a lot of credit because they've been banged up. That's one of the reasons why they haven't been able to run it, and they're getting healthy now, and you can see they're playing much better tonight.
Robinson in motion on first down, flag out. Merriweather met right near the line of scrimmage by Champ Fells. We've said the Buck linebacker, Champ Fells' name quite a bit. False start on the Redhawks. 128 rushing yards for Miami. They came in second to last in the Football Bowl subdivision, averaging half that basically. 63 per game.
And they've committed to it tonight, and I think that's one of the reasons why. You know, coming in, Thomas Merriweather, who's a very capable back like we're seeing tonight, he's only carried the ball more than 11 times in a game twice this year. So they haven't really committed to the run game because of the injuries up front. But now they're getting healthy. They're committed to it tonight. You can see they're having some success.
First and 15. Throwing on at the 25-yard line. Davis, the tackle of Harwell.
You know, the back end has been the issue for Bowling Green defensively. They've got a lot of young guys in the secondary. they play this matchup zone where it's really zone, but at some point in time, it turns into man-to-man depending on who runs through your zone. And for these young cornerbacks, it's taken them a number of games and most of the year to really understand the concept, and they've given up a lot of big plays through the air.
Well, because of the fog, we're going to give you a few more lower looks back closer to the field. Dicer under pressure, and that's incomplete at the 28-yard line. Jones put the pressure on Dicer. Merriweather, the back, out of the backfield, the intended receiver.
Falcon fans, due to fog, driving conditions are extremely hazardous. When leaving the game tonight, please drive slowly and use extreme caution.
So third down and 7. Redhawks 5 of 9 on third down tonight. Nice with the throw. And that is caught by DeMarco Payne. And Payne has enough for the first down.
Marco Payne, number 13, just going to come down and just run right across the middle. You can see the short route makes Javon Laycock, number 11, jump up on that, and that opens up that deep dig for DeMarco Payne.
Payne, who was a high school teammate of Merriweather's at Hazelwood East in the St. Louis suburbs. Payne played a little bit at the University of Iowa in 2008, a couple of games. Transferred to Iowa Central Community College and now to Miami. First and 10 from the 13. And it's Merriweather running a left inside the 5-yard line.
And that's what's hurt Bowling Green's defense. There's a flag down on the play, but allowing Merriweather to get to the outside, when they contain him and keep him between the tackles, they do a pretty good job of tackling him.
Going to come back, apparently a hold here by Gibbons. Wide receiver Chris Gibbons. A look at the fog here at Dwight Perry Stadium. Bowling Green, Ohio. It has steadily gotten worse. Much worse than this, JC. Yeah, it does become an issue.
Yeah, it is. It's getting very thick and getting tough for us to see up here from our vantage point. Don't think it's really affecting the guys on the field. They're still pretty clear down low.
Dicer towards the end zone. Caught. Touchdown. Nick Harwell. His fourth touchdown catch of the season. 27 Miami. A 22-yard touchdown catch for the redshirt freshman from the Houston area.
Yeah, the fog didn't affect him at all. Saw this ball all the way. Just got inside the corner on that post route. Just double post, clear the safety out, and now you throw the ball to Harwell. He's got Adrian Spencer on his back. Easy catch for him.
The point after for Trevor Cook. I'm going to have to watch the official on that one. And they say good. So 2:40 to go in the third quarter, and it's 21-7 Miami.
This is Jim Tressel of the Ohio State University Buckeyes. And for all the brave men and women who are serving our country and serving freedom all over the world, we cannot thank you enough. We get to do what we love to do, and that's compete in the game of football and live in this free country. And our players get to go to college and get a degree and see if they can become all they can be because of your sacrifice and your family's sacrifice. So thanks so much for what you do. We're so humbled to be in this country, which is led by you.
A All this week, ESPN honoring veterans and troops of the United States Armed Services with America's Heroes, a salute to our veterans, culminating in special Sports Center editions live from Germany. Schedule of programs connecting sports with military service and pay tribute to those who have served and do so today. Veterans Day tomorrow, the tip of our cap to the veterans.
Amen. Father served in the Marine Corps. The veteran grew up in Oceanside, Camp Pendleton, so know a lot of veterans in that area.
In Oceanside, this would be called the Marine Lair, but we're a long way from the ocean. That bounces all the way back to the 15-yard line. Boo Boo Gates. And that's where the Falcons will start from. They joined ESPN in support of our troops, wounded warriors, and their families. You can donate $10 by texting USO to 27722 or go to www.uso.org.
And on that kickoff, that might have been an issue with the fog, with the ball up so high. And that's why you see those guys not able to field it in the back end, because the ball gets up in that fog and you lose it. But it hasn't gotten down to the field level yet, so they shouldn't have a problem throwing and catching.
The Falcons begin from their own 13. Shields looking to throw, does so, going towards the near sideline. It bounces off the intended receiver, was caught. Was he inbounds? Deion Nunley saying he was inbounds. It bounced off Wiley, and Miami football. Interception for Nunley, his team-leading fourth of the season.
And watch this ball. A great thrown ball. It just bounces, looks like, off of his shoulder pad. Deion Nunley just trailing on the play, just gets the rebound. You can see the ball hits his hand first and then bounces up. Nunley's able to come down with it. Looks like he definitely gets his feet in bounds. It's a ball that's got to be caught, though. Calvin Wiley, a sixth-year senior, has been around a long time. That's a ball that he has to catch.
You see Nunley walking the tightrope. Right there along the sideline to get the feet down.
Yeah, the tap, tap.
And the turnover gives it back to Miami, and Merriweather turns the left corner. And he picks up 11, first down. Laycock and Woods on the tackle. ...88 yards rushing for Merriweather, came in averaging 36 a game. Merriweather stood up at the 30-yard line by Fells and Woods. Ball comes loose, but they say he was down. Line judge Mark Bennett came in quickly and said that was not a live football, but boy, Dave Clawson is arguing the point.
Yeah, good tackle by Dwayne Woods, number five. Watch him take on the lead blocker right there. Plays off of that and makes the tackle on Merriweather. They've got him stood up and trying to rip the ball out.
While he was falling backwards, it comes out.
The whistle had blown.
Right.
Called him down.
Austin Boucher, the quarterback for Dicer here for Miami. Boucher, a redshirt freshman. Hand off. Tracy Woods, the backup running back through freshman games two. There is Boucher. He's from Kettering, Ohio. His twin brother, Colin, linebacker on the team as well. Boucher had a perfect 4.0 grade point average for the fall 2009 semester. And we've talked about how big academics are really at both schools.
Yeah, big time. Both coaches make sure that their players get to the classroom, sit in the front, and make sure that they get their grades.
Third and seven, Boucher running. short of the first down. Woods and Alvarado tracked him down. The ball at the 24-yard line. And they're going to let the rest of the time expire here in this third quarter of the course. And they determine whether they will attempt a field goal towards the north end zone fog
or not.
We'll head into the fourth quarter from Doyle Perry Stadium in Bowling Green, Ohio. Miami leading Bowling Green 21-7. Miami leading Bowling Green 21-7. Mark Neely along with J.C. Pearson and our ESPN crew. And Red Hawks have elected to attempt a 41-yard field goal, which if they hit it, would give them a three-score lead here. Make it a three-score game.
Yeah, smart move here to kick the ball. Makeable. Not a lot of wind down here at all.
Cook off the left hash. Did not get it. So the miss keeps it a 21-7 game. Let's take a look back at our covered spotlight brought to you by Travelers Insurance. And this bounces off of Wiley. And Deion Nunley with the pick.
Yeah, good heads-up play by Deion Nunley. He's beat on the play, but he doesn't give up on the play.
or the ball. He's able to just concentrate, bring it in, keep his feet in bounds, and a big turnover.
Shields pump fakes. He's going deep down the near sideline. A little contact. No flags. Incomplete. Jordan saying he got a little bit of a push there from Brown and Hinkle. Incomplete.
Tamar Jordan, their best receiver, you see, just tries to run a hook and go. There's some contact right there. Easily could have been called, but again, you're working on DJ Brown, who is their best cover corner. You might want to think about going and trying to work on the other corner, Brandon Stevens, who always plays to the wide field, and that's where Tamar Jordan is now.
Chills 0 for his last six with an interception in that span. Play fake, looking to throw again. Complete, but immediately dropped at the 20-yard line by Evan Harris. Willie Jeter, the running back, made the catch, but loses a yard. Look at the total yards by half.
So Bowling Green, the second half, just hasn't been able to get anything going. You know, still they have all these creative things that they were going to do offensively to try to create some plays. We've yet to see some of those, and you know, now they're getting to the point where they've got to throw the ball even more than they wanted to.
Falcons 1-9 on third down, third and 11, thrown deep, and he's got a man open, caught! Nothing but green for Jordan. Can he be caught from behind? Yes, but did he get in? No!
Yes!
Yes, says the official on the far side. Touchdown. Jordan's fourth of the season. 77-yard touchdown.
And this is what I've been saying all night. Put him to the field so he can work on Brandon Stevens, who's not their best corner guy. You can see right now, 24. He's a little confused on who he's supposed to match up with. And Brandon Jordan just runs, or Kamar Jordan, rather, just runs right by him. Turns it into a huge touchdown for Bowling Green. Going to get caught here at the end.
So Quarles come from behind and try to strip it and make the tackle.
And they're reviewing it. He's going to be just short here, but still a huge play for Bowling Green. You can see when he comes down right here, he's not over the end line, and even the ball right there never even crosses the plane of the end zone. So this is going to come back. It's going to be first and goal to goal here. But what a huge play for Bowling Green.
Yeah, there was the best look right there. The momentum took him into the end zone, and you saw the back judge there. Mike Elliott did not signal touchdown until he saw the official along the pylon signal touchdown.
What a big play, and gets them right back in this ball game if they can convert here. If it's overruled, which I think it will be, but Bowling Green, I'm sure they'll take the play.
Well, worse, they're looking at first and goal from inside the one, or at the one.
There's a little more, and I think that's smoke right there from the cannon fire right there, thinking it's a touchdown. So you add the smoke with the fog, and it makes it even tougher to see.
It's almost like football at 35,000 feet here all of a sudden. The fog here in Northwest Ohio. They are reviewing, ruling on field is a touchdown, which if it stands would be a 77-yard touchdown catch and run. There's the cannon, which is added to the fog.
You can see when he comes down right there.
And knees down.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's not in. Stan Evans, our referee. Unfortunately, his mic is out, but his arms
have not gone up.
Yeah.
So they're going to have to come back onto the field. And it'll be first and goal from the one. And for the moment, anyway, right now it's still a 21-7 game. Which, according to the video, is the right call.
Yeah, definitely was the right call. He was down short of the end zone. But Bowling Green can't be upset with it being overruled. That was a huge play for them. Gets them first and goal from the one. Now all they've got to do is make sure they punch it in.
Just driving forward, Shills still, nope, line judge says touchdown. They shoot off the cannon again.
Yeah, and more smoke, but.
I tell you what, did he get
call.
In?
Yeah, what a late call. I thought he was down for sure. Not going to be able to, there he is right there, and he's down.
I don't know about
short
that one.
Of the goal line, and then he just keeps crawling and crawling. They finally give him the touchdown, but I think if this is reviewed again, it's going to be second down. But
Bowling
yeah,
Green
here comes the review.
Kick this as quickly as possible, but no, this is going to get reviewed. And I got a feeling this is coming back.
Yeah.
I don't know if I've ever seen two touchdowns in a row. Come back.
Yeah, and
off the
this
board.
Is an easy call. You see, he's already down right there. Left knee is already on the ground, clearly short of the goal line. Good stop, stacking it up. Left knee's on the ground.
All right, how big an issue is the fog here for the officials?
Well, it could be. You know, you combine the fog with all the bodies stacking up inside, and it's tough to see because it was a late call. See the official. Lineman coming in right there, and it's a late call, and he's the one that's going to signal touchdown.
It's been a busy night for Tom Workman, our replay official.
See, Coach Clawson is not very happy already. He knows the outcome.
No, we don't need to hear it. We can already tell you this is coming back
yeah.
off the board a second time. So it's going to be second and goal from the one. So the call reversed again. I tell you what, if they do stick it in here and then Cannon goes off again. We may not be able to see
yeah.
the football field. All right. So second and goal from the one. Still a 21-7 Miami lead. Hand off. No doubt about this one. Into the end zone. Jeter, touchdown. Fifth rushing touchdown of the season for Jeter. He has a receiving touchdown as well, so his sixth overall of the season. This is what helped get him down there close. A couple of reviews later, they finally do get it in with Willie Jeter, the senior.
Hey, good step by Willie Jeter just to slide a bit to his left away from number 90, Austin Brown.
The extra point up and good. We've got most of this fourth quarter left to play, and it is a 7-point game in foggy Bowling Green.
Fourth quarter, Miami leading Bowling Green 21-14 as the Falcons will kick off. Burkhart to kick it away for Bowling Green. With Danny Green and Payne back deep. Who will be a quarterback for the Redhawks as a Dinesert or Boucher. He will come down at the 10, dropped. And picked up by Green, and he's tripped up at the 16. Austin Collier on the tackle on special teams. Will it be? Dysart there on the left, Boucher on the right. Boucher finished the last drive as quarterback. The reason they're waiting is there's a flag on the field.
Yeah, Boucher's all buckled up there. Dysart's not.
Hawks will be pushed back even further. Well, out comes Dicer. Oh, cat and mouse going on there. What's both? As you said, Boucher looked buckled up.
Yeah,
there you go.
I don't know why they would take Dicer out anyway. I mean, he's played a pretty good ball game tonight.
Very good starting field position most of the night, does not hear. Officials blowing the whistle before we can get a snap, no flags. Get it worked out, whatever was the reason for the delay there.
I think if you're Bowling Green, you got to expect a run here, but you won't have to sell out and gamble. You've been playing pretty good defense.
Woods. Tackled by Magnoni. Now to the studio. Let's check in with Ryan Burr. Ryan. Second down and three here for Miami. From their own 15-yard line, hand it off again to Woods, stacked up. Maybe got a yard. Before met by Darius Smith and Paul Swan. Woods getting the carries here with Merriweather on the sideline at the moment, though both are pretty similar runners, about the same size, both 5'10", both about 210 pounds, both for the most part downhill physical runners. Merriweather close to season highs. Third down and two. Hand off Woods, stacked up, and he will be short. Chris Jones, the nose tackle. And it looks like the Redhawks could have to punt it from deep in their own end.
Yeah, and a good series defensively for Bowling Green. And we talked all night is when they've had trouble stopping the run is when they've let the running back get outside and break contain. They've done a good job when the running backs had to stay inside between the tackles like we just saw. They come up with the big stop.
Cooper back at midfield to receive this punt for Bowling Green.
Yeah, it's going to be tough for him, though, up in the fog. Got to make sure that he sees the ball and secures it.
Murphy for the punt. Pre-snap flag. And he's going to get pushed back even further. Well, a couple of possessions ago, Miami was a field goal attempt away from making this a three-score game. Now they're kicking, punting from their own end zone in a one-score game.
Special teams. Can't forget about that. Such a huge part in every game. The team that usually makes the most special teams plays wins the game.
Murphy sends Cooper back to his own 47-yard line. Now running right, retreating. And is tackled at midfield. But great starting field position for Bowling Green. A late flag does come flying out.
Timeout on the field.
Let's see if the starting field position will be as good as we anticipated for the Falcons. Maybe even a little better.
Or a little worse.
Exactly.
It's a huge
Either
penalty
way.
For whoever it's on.
Personal foul against the Redhawks. So it will improve the Falcons' starting field position into Redhawks territory. So we'll take a timeout. 10:41 to go. Falcons trail it by 7, but they'll have the football.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Nissan, proud partner of the Heisman Trophy, and Cooper Tires. Don't give up a thing.
10:41 left, fourth quarter, 21-14. Miami leading Bowling Green here in the fog in Bowling Green, Ohio. The 15-yard personal foul adding to the return, so the Falcons begin at the 34-yard line of Miami. Shields under center. Jordan comes in motion. Now back to the near side. Play fake. Rolling right. Shields. Along the sideline. That is a catch for the tight end Bear.
Pass complete to number 82, Alex Bear.
Now here in the second half,
the coverage for Miami number 6, DJ Brown.
This football game has been dominated by the fog.
Game of six, that's
a look at this play.
Down. 4 yards to go. From the Miami 28.
Wow, what a catch along the sideline just before.
Keeps his foot in bounds.
It would have hit the turf. Bear, the tight end.
Yeah, that's tough for big guys to go down catch that ball with their hands down that low.
Barry West, his first touchdown catch of the season tonight. That is incomplete at the 20, intended for Cooper. In the second half, the story has been the fog, and also Miami and the interceptions. That one for Nunley with the catch and run, getting near the goal line for Jordan. Initially, they rolled him in there, but review to bring it back out. They would eventually score with a touchdown run for Jeter. But it's all happened a little cloudier. It's Cooper in motion, left side. Shields going to run with it and sliding stop inside the 20. Picks up eight.
Yeah, got the first down. Got up the field. We saw in the first half where he almost had a first down and lost it by going sideways, but good job pulling the ball down, pulling that right shoulder through, and getting enough yards up the field for a first down.
And Matt Schultz, the redshirt freshman from Arcadia, California. Moving the chains, they have a first down from the 20, and under 10 minutes to go.
This is an area of the field where it generally is tougher to throw the ball, but for Shields, he's been very good all year long in the red zone throwing the football. 17 of 23, four touchdowns, no interceptions, but now they're going Hopgood, kind of the Wildcat.
Cooper in motion.
Oh, there's that double handoff.
That's Wiley near a first down at the 10. Terrell Wedge.
Now that's one. Yeah, that's one of those plays that they were telling us about yesterday, that they were going to bring out kind of that wing T double handoff. You're going to see. Watch the double handoff. Here he goes, and now Calvin Wiley, number six, comes back under.
They called it the counter crisscross, which is a tip of the cap to Tubby Raymond. You know, he used to coach at Delaware with the wing, too.
Yeah, they pulled that out from the 30s and the 40s.
Going back away.
Hey, whatever works, they got first and goal.
Wiley lining up at the quarterback position now.
And here's the inverted wishbone.
Jeter may have lost a yard.
What they're trying to get accomplished with that formation is they can run some misdirection out of it. They can run some zone reads. They can run the option. But when they throw the ball, you can see Shields right here has been very good this season throwing the ball in the red zone. 74% completions, five touchdowns, no interceptions. And the red zone is generally where it's tougher to throw the ball. But he's done a great job of it all year.
Under 8 minutes to go. Bowling Green. Driving here, looking for the game tie touchdown. Shields still rolling right along the sideline. They say a catch there for Wiley at the six. Interested to see the feet of Wiley here, see if he had one in.
Yeah, they try to move Shields outside the pocket. And yeah, that's a good grab. Calvin Wiley has 2 feet in and control of the ball.
Good look there, as good as we get through the fog. The third and goal now from the six. Well, two receivers to the right. And one to the left is Pronti. He's going Pronti now in motion to the left. Play clock was winding down, going towards the end zone, incomplete. A leaping attempt by Jordan. The flag is out, though. The coverage. Terrell Wedge, as well as Pat Hinkle.
Yeah, and kind of a strange coverage because Terrell Wedge is the inside linebacker, and he's out in coverage. on Kamar Jordan. Yeah, just early. Pat Hinkle, number 37, the safety coming over. Is definitely early. And that's the pass interference. You can see right there already contact being made. That's a good call.
So it gives it first and goal from the two. And running right into the end zone. Touchdown, Jeter, and the Falcons an extra point away from tying this game with just under 7 minutes left. Jeter's second touchdown run of this second half. Now they can get the PAT through the fog and through the uprights. We'll be all square here.
Good drive. But remember, all started with that big personal foul penalty on the punt that gave Bowling Green excellent field position to start this drive.
Burkhart for the point after. That is good. Jeter's second touchdown run of the game fires the cannon. And with 6:59 to go, Miami and Bowling Green tied at 21.
Miami head coach Michael Haywood, his team won only one game last year. They beat Toledo on Halloween night. On the night tonight, with the fog that kind of makes it seem like Halloween, tied at 21 with 6:59 to go fourth quarter. Playing one of his rivals, Bowling Green. And the Falcons. The kickoff.
Yeah, it's going to be tough to catch this kickoff, too, if he gets it high in the air in this deep fog.
Taking it to 12. Near the 30-yard line, Marshall making the stop. In comes the sophomore quarterback, Zach Dicer. Let's take a look at our Life's Good flashback brought to you by LG. And one of the great quarterbacks, if not the greatest, for Miami, Ben Roethlisberger. Earlier part of the last decade. 10,829 passing yards, 80 touchdown passes, holds every major passing record in their school history. I'll tell you what, the MAC has had a number of good quarterbacks in addition to Miami. That was caught and then dropped by Gibbons. Coming back the other way is Bowling Green down the near sideline. Eugene Champ fouls, and the Falcons, like they have it inside the 20-yard line. Well, this was caught initially by Givens and then lost it.
Yeah, he got possession of the ball. Then it comes out. It's tough to see if he was down or not, but they ruled it a fumble.
Flag on the return. Another look at the catch and then fumble.
Then when does the ball come out? The knee is down.
Ooh, they may review this.
Yeah, it's hard to see from that angle where the ball was.
I tell you what, that look, just seeing that last look.
Now here's where you're going to get a good look, when maybe not. Knee is down, but the ball looked like it was actually coming out before his knee hit.
It was an illegal block in the back on the return, and they are going to review this. Now let's look at it from.
Yeah, you're not going to get a good look from this angle. You're going to see his knee go down, but you're not going to be able to see when the ball comes out.
The ball was shielded by his body there where you couldn't tell, but this look here.
It's tough. Yeah, it's tough. It looks like the ball was out prior to his knee coming down, but that's close. But the ruling on the field was a fumble, so it has to be clearly indisputable that that knee was actually down for them to overrule it. Down with possession of the ball.
And that last look that we saw appears to be the best look. Here's each look.
Great split screen. Yeah. You see his knee down, and you can't see the ball. Can't see
if the ball coming out in the right, though. Knee down on the left. Now these are synced up in actual time. Now the ball's starting to come out.
Yeah, it's tough to see. Boy, that's a tough one. When does the ball actually start to come out? The knee is down there. Does he still maintain possession of the ball at that point? See right there, if the knee is down, looked like he still has possession, and then the ball starts to come out, but the ball comes out right here, but the knee is already down. But again, it has to be clearly conclusive and indisputable, and I don't know if that's enough to overturn it. That's too close.
And what we just saw there was some great tricks of the production trade from our crew there. Does the booth official get to use those two looks that are synced up, or is he using them individually? And if you use them individually, I don't think you can overturn the call, can you?
I don't think so.
Well, the fog and the plot
thickens.
Is thickening.
There you go.
That is Stan Evans, the referee. This is a big decision here. And it's going to be Bowling Green football.
I'm glad the fans could hear.
Unfortunately, his mic is out.
Yeah, and I was just looking at his arms and see which way he was pointing with the ball. But Bowling Green's going to get it. So there was not enough evidence there to overturn the call on the field.
So Falcons ball from the Miami 35-yard line, tied at 21 with 6:37 to go. Jordan, the receiver there at the right in the bottom of the screen, and immediately hit and dropped for a loss. Jeter, Austin Brown with the tackle for loss.
And just jumped the snap. Did you see how fast he got off the ball? He just jumped the snap. Watch number 90. Did a great job getting off, and then just swims Chip Robinson, number 71, just whiffs on the block.
Loss of five. It's second down at 15. Jordan in motion. Sears Still looking to throw and gets sacked back at the 45, and the Falcons are going in the wrong direction. Jordan Brown, number 79, the junior from Chicago with the sack.
Two big plays by the defensive line from Miami. Austin Brown on the first play with the tackle for a loss. Now Jordan Brown on second down comes up with the big sack. That's what you have to do defensively, regardless of the situation. You put in an adverse situation, you got to come in and get a stop. And they can get a stop here on third and 20. Be a great job by them defensively in this series.
Shields under pressure again, and now he's sacked back at his own 45-yard line. And Justin Sims with the sack. Well, we've mentioned about every name of that front four here. These first three plays, it was Brown, Austin Brown, then Jordan Brown, and now Jason Sims. There is a flag out. They're going to take the personal foul to chop block.
No, both declined.
Oh, declined to take the sack because three plays,
and
they lose 20 yards.
It's fourth down, and now they've got to punt the ball away.
Yeah, fourth and 30.
Yeah, I think you got to punt. What a series for Miami defensively, though. That defensive line, without having to blitz anybody else, got the job done. Three straight plays.
Back at his own 10-yard line. The right punt is caught, and I think that's just the main thing that Payne wanted to do, was just catch the football, which he does. And Miami will have it inside their own 20-yard line. Big-time college football action continues all week on ESPN and ESPN2. First on ESPN tomorrow night, 7:30 Eastern. Big East leader Pitt takes on Connecticut. And ESPN2 Friday night at 9 Eastern. Kellen Moore and number 4 Boise State take on Idaho. Go to ESPN.com for more information. So the Redhawks have it first and 10 from their 16-yard line. Under 5 minutes to play in regulation. Tied at 21. Robinson comes back in motion. Dicer dumps it. Caught at the 30-yard line. To the 35 goes Armand Robinson, the senior from Reynoldsburg.
And that was one of the things that really concerned Bowling Green coming into this game, is the way that Dicer's able to move around, buy some time, and still keep his eyes down the field and make a play. And that was a concern for him. We hadn't seen him throw the ball on the run yet tonight until that play. Turns out to be a big play for him.
17th, the Redhawks' first down of the night. The officials whistle it. A timeout called by Miami is the reason for the whistle there. Tied at 21, 4:34 to go. Miami football. Tell you what, JC, I know you've had recurring dreams where perhaps you show up at school and you're not dressed appropriately, and maybe this is
don't know where my classroom is,
where you're calling and broadcasting a football game, but something's not quite right here with the fog. This is certainly unusual circumstance.
It is. It's getting thick out there too, getting tough for us to see up here. We got to kind of rely on the monitors, but don't know if it's affecting the guys on the field yet. I don't think the fog is low enough yet, whereas they're having trouble seeing the football, so that you can still throw the ball in this. Even though it's tough for us to see it, you know, you can see it's tough for them to see us up here also.
Well, after the Redhawks timeout, they have it first and 10 from their own 35-yard line. Still some standing around.
I don't know what the delay is all about, but you know, no reason for Miami here to panic and try to leave their game plan and start throwing the ball way down the field. They still have plenty of time. They can still run it, get Merriweather going again in the run game, run some screens. They can still run their entire package. Got plenty of time, four and a half minutes and two timeouts.
I think this is a question about the clock. Over here, someone down there saying it should be at 4:28. And now they do change it on the scoreboard from 4:34 to 4:28. Dysart. He's going to run and has room down the middle of the field to midfield. A sliding stop there. He picks up 15.
And what you can't do if you're Bowling Green defensively is play too loose and play that prevent type of defense and give up everything underneath. We saw a big pass on the first play to Armand Robinson, and now Dysart comes back with the big run. So defensively, you still have to play tough defense and can't just give them things because all they need is a field goal.
Minutes to go, clock running. Dysart throws to the middle of the field. That is caught by Harwell. To the 45-yard line, Andre Davis stopping Harwell. Jason Rainey, who handles the game camera down there along the field.
Yeah, tough to see, but
yeah, better vision.
Yeah, there it is. Without him, we'd be blind right now because definitely can't see very much from up here.
Harwell with that catch, by the way, now over 100 yards receiving, 7 catches, 107 yards, and a touchdown catch. Second and one. Woods. It's another first down for the Redhawks. Another tackle for Henry Davis.
Yeah, great block on the edge over there, too, on the right side. I think that was the right tackle, Josh Harvey. Fantastic block that allowed runner to get to the corner. It's a flag.
Yeah, walking back. Holding against the Redhawks. Merriweather has ceded most of the carries in the second half to Tracy Woods. He does have a season high as far as carries, most of those in the first half. And under pressure, being chased and sacked by Marshall.
Great job by Dwayne Wood, number 5 inside backer. You're going to see him flash right now. Just kind of a delayed blitz. He lets the blockers get tied up, and then he just comes right up the middle, flushes them to Calvin Marshall for the big sack. Now it's a third and very, very long.
Penalty is an illegal shift. That penalty is declined.
It's a flag and an illegal shift.
Yeah, it's hard for us. We can't even see the flags on the field.
Called against Miami. That refused. Third down and 26. Dysart. Almost picked off by Dwayne Woods. And a Miami drive that was headed downfield, stalled and went in the wrong direction, and then almost turned it over here.
Yeah, sure did. Dwayne Woods just sitting in the middle of the field. Almost comes up with a huge interception for Bowling Green. Dyson never sees him. Tries to throw it back across the field, rolling to his left, and lucky that ball's not intercepted.
Murphy to punt. Cooper retreating. That's it up near the 30. Tackled by Kokel.
Eugene Cooper on the return.
Saturday night, ESPN delivers an SEC showdown. Steve Spurrier returns to the Swamp, where his Gamecocks will take on Urban Meyer of the Florida Gators. College football primetime presented by Hampton Hotels on ESPN Saturday at 7:15 Eastern. Also available online and on your phone. Taken by Miami, D.J. Brown. It is indeed. A Falcons turnover. Brown gets the pick.
It will be first and 10.
Wow, what a big play.
On the Bowling Green 36.
Try to throw it to the short side. Shields just eyes the receiver down. Bad throw. It looks like that ball might have hit the ground, didn't it?
Going to be really tough to tell, but it may have.
Tough to tell in this fog, but it looks like that ball may have hit the turf. If I'm Miami, I'm just going to get up and quick snap the ball. Don't give them a chance to review it.
Here comes the review.
Too late.
How many of these have we had tonight?
You know, that's a play that I would think teams would work on. When it's something that close, just get up and snap the ball, spike the ball, because once you run the play, then they can't review it.
We've had four plays reviewed just on the goal line alone tonight. That was Merriweather. That was originally ruled on the field not as a touchdown, but reviewed into a touchdown. That was reviewed and turned into a touchdown. And here comes Jordan. This was called a touchdown on the field and overturned, though Bowling Green would push it in eventually. But before that, this was called a touchdown for Shields. That was brought back. The booth has been busy tonight. But this obviously huge call here. Ruling on the field is interception.
It's tough to see, but this ball is way short, and boy, it looks like it hopped before DJ Brown caught it. Boy, you got to have some good eyes. Hard to tell from that angle. I think the first shot we had was probably the best look right there. Right there, boy, it just looks like that ball to me bounced off the ground.
But is it enough to overturn?
In this fog, huh?
Right.
Man, that's tough.
Stan Evans, our referee. This fog has been around for the second half. Here's the call.
Ball stands.
So unable to see enough on video to overturn it.
What a big call that is, too.
So it's going to give the Redhawks the football inside Bowling Green territory with 2:03 remaining in regulation.
Wow, that's tough, but there's just not enough there, and it's just too hard to see with all this fall.
Dysart throws to Harwell to the 30. Miami trying to create a three-way logjam atop the East Division in the back. If they can get a win tonight, also trying to become, would become bowl eligible with the win. They're 5-4 coming in, 4-1 in conference play. Bowling Green looking for their second consecutive conference win. Second down and 2. Give it to motion. Swing out right side. And it's caught again by Harwell for a first down. Just look at the Mid-American Conference East Division. Temple and Ohio both 5-1 leading the division. Miami at 4-1 coming in. Bowling Green with a conference win last week at Central Michigan. Bowling Green's been involved in a lot of tight games. Another one here with Michael Haywood and the Redhawks. Dicer certainly has his favorite target on this drive right now, Nick Harwell.
Yeah, he's been the favorite guy. He's been that guy for the last 4 weeks. But if you're Bowling Green, you just have to tighten up your coverage here. You're giving them too much. You know, those 2-3 yard, 5-6 yard gains add up, and now all of a sudden they're in great field goal range.
And Trevor Cook, the place kicker, who's back this week, injured his left leg on October 16th at Central Michigan in what was a fake field goal play. Long 48. And now the Redhawks at the 19-yard line with 53 seconds remaining. Bowling Green just used their second timeout.
I'd be real surprised if Miami throws the ball here. Why risk an interception? Just run. You're already in field goal range. Your field goal kicker is very accurate, although he's coming back from injury. This is his first game back, but really don't expect to see them run the ball, throw the ball down here.
Yeah, Cook missed from 41, remember, which would have made it a three-score game when it was 21-7 Miami. And since the Falcons have scored twice to tie it. Second down and 5. Dicer. Incomplete.
Try to get the hook and go outside. Try to get it all. I think that's what Coach Haywood is saying. We stop the clock. I mean, you want the clock to continue to run. Try to end it on a field goal at the last second and don't give Bowling Green a chance at the ball. That's why I'm surprised that they threw it and didn't run the ball there.
Third down and 5. The 19 of the Falcons. Nicer goes to the sideline. Play clock at 19, so not used it. Timeout here. They have 2 remaining.
Yeah, if you do run the ball here, you want to run it to the middle of the field. Give your kicker a chance to kick it right from the middle of the field.
Especially when it's tough to see the crossbar and the goal post.
That's what they're doing. I'm sure they. Now it's
Woods. He's inside the 15. Clock stops with 40 seconds remaining. He picks up 5. They needed 5. Is this a first down or not?
Looks like they've moved the sticks. It is a first down.
Oh, Football in the fog from Bowling Green, Ohio. 40 seconds remaining in regulation. This MAC East battle between Miami and Bowling Green tied at 21. Red Hawks have a first and 10 from the 14 of the Falcons. Dicer goes to the middle of the field, takes a knee.
Now they got it to the middle of the field like they want it. Now just going to let the clock run down and try to kick the game-winning field goal.
Trevor Cook, 0 for 1 tonight. He missed from 41. This would be about a 34-yard attempt. We get it down to a couple of seconds and burn the timeout. So
timeout Miami.
It's either going to be a game-winning field goal or we will be headed to overtime.
Yeah. Then you go back to the interception that Shields threw. Such a huge play at that point of the game. A couple minutes left, gave Miami great field position.
Timeout left. You want to try to ice Trevor Cook. Big play that's allowed this possible game-winning field goal. The interception. Did it bounce? No, it stood.
Yeah.
DJ Brown. 33-yard attempt for the game. Trevor Cook. And now this will not count. Looks like he did hit it, but a timeout was called by Bowling Green. Final timeout used by the Falcons. This has been a bizarre night, JC.
It has. With the weather, the calls,
yes,
the reviews, all the way down through the last one. You're Bowling Green, you just blame it on the fog if it doesn't work out for you.
But it may not be over.
It may not be
for
over.
A while here. We'll see.
You still have to make the kick. And you're telling your guys, just try to penetrate, get your hands up, see if you can block the kick.
Now when it does in, whatever that may be, Sports Center is next. 33-yard attempt. Trevor Cook, no timeouts remaining for Bowling Green, so this is it. Out of the hole to Dicer for the game. It is through, and Miami wins it. Final score, Red Hawks 24, Falcons 21, and Miami gets their sixth win of the season. They go to 5-1 in conference play and create that three-team logjam atop the East. It's as good a look as we got through the fog, JC.
Yeah, no question about it. Nails it. They tried to ice him. No problem.
But Trevor Cook just back from injury. Again, injured his left leg back on October 16th in the Central Michigan game. They get him back and he kicks the game winner with no time left. But Miami goes to 6-4, 5-1 in conference play. And let's look at the MAC East Division. You've got Temple, Ohio, and Miami, all 5-1. The Red Hawks are now bowl eligible.
Yep, all three bowl eligible. What a great ball game. In-state rivals, the fog, a lot of calls. Miami hangs in there and kicks the game winner at the end.
Well, again, the final. 24-21, Miami wins it over Bowling Green. Sports Center coming up next. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For J.C. Pearson and her entire ESPN crew, I'm Mark Neely. Thanks for sharing this one with us in the fog.